For those in the market for flavor, there's Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, a flavorful drink that's a modern twist on a Mexican street classic. With four vibrant and refreshing flavors, pineapple, watermelon, hibiscus, and cucumber lime, made with a splash of real fruit juice. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas are perfect for any fiesta, small or big. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, boldly authentic, vibrantly flavorful. Drink responsibly. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas flavored beers imported by Crown Imports, Chicago, Illinois. Hibiscus contains juice only for color.
Without the ones like you, who work tirelessly to keep things running, everything would suddenly stop. Hospitals, factories, schools, and power plants, they all depend on you. No matter the weather, emergency, or time of day, you're the ones who get it done. At Grainger, we're here for you with professional-grade industrial supplies. Count on real-time product availability and fast delivery. Call, clickgrainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
At Metro, get an iPhone 12 with 5G and a dual camera system for $99.99. Take amazing pictures and share them instantly. And don't put up with life's yada yada.
Yada yada.
Like photo bombers. Zoom, crop out,
yada yada,
and bye.
You don't take yada yada in life, don't take yada yada from your wireless provider. Get iPhone 12 with 5G with no activation fees and nada yada yada. Only at Metro by T-Mobile. Switch to Metro, bring your ID. This offer isn't available for customers currently at T-Mobile or that have been with Metro in the past 180 days.
Nature has developed a lot of natural defenses. Take it from a little bug like me. I've pretty much seen them all. Porcupines got quills. Snakes got venom. And me, I got camouflage. Nature's always finding ways to support life, like elderberries. Nature's Way extracted the best of the berry, tossed in vitamin C and D and zinc, and put them into a yummy immune-supporting gummy. Nature's Way Sambucus Gummies. Powerful immune support inspired by nature. Nature's Way.
What's up? It's your boy, The Ted Smith from The Men's Room. And did you know I have a podcast? Well, I do. The Podcast. New episodes uploaded every Wednesday on the Odyssey app.
Unfortunately, what you're about to hear is real. The members of this radio program are simply not that bright, or what some people would call educated. They are merely stupid. They're not trying to offend anyone on purpose. And all have played doctors on TV. You have been warned and are cordially invited to join the party. This is the Men's Room.
Forget it, man, and get with the countdown. Get with the countdown. Shake this square world and blast off for Kicksville. The Trippers, the Grasshoppers, the Hip Ones, all gathered in secrecy and flying high as a kite.
This is the Men's Room with Miles and Thrill. You know what they say, shake your radio more than three times, and you're playing with it. You're listening to the Men's Room.
And away we go. Welcome to season 19 and episode number 4098. Along with Steve the Thrill Hill, the Ted Smith, and Mike Hawk. Montgomery! And you are the Men's Room. On tap today, the return of Who Sucks Less. We have tickets to Metallica. We will play Profile This, plus headlines, Men's Room Shot of the Day, fundable listener emails, and everyone's favorite, TV Time with Ted.
A clack.
Ringing it down. All right, here we go. Miami TSA catches a man trying to smuggle a bag of snakes in his pants. Meanwhile, when a first date ends with a woman shooting at you, the relationship doesn't stand a chance. Cops find a stolen Seattle pickup in Cali with drugs, goats, and chickens inside.
Of course.
Two men busted at Heathrow with suitcases full of cocaine from Jamaica they were trying to hide. And a 9-year-old hits a home run the day after saving his parents' life. That is all coming on today's very special episode of The Men's Room.
And now, here's the question.
Hola, bitches. Good day to you and yours. All right, Times Square, New York. The Strip in Vegas, Disney World in Orlando, Florida. Now, these are celebrated places here in the U.S., but that does not mean that there isn't a vocal minority that poop on these places for one reason or another. And everyone has their own experience that paints their opinion, and that's very fair. I mean, look, Hawaii, beautiful. But for how much it costs, I don't plan on going back. Plus, I'm not a dude that likes being trapped at a resort. It's great for some people, but not for me. But all of that said, I'd never tell anyone not to go. If you get the chance, do it. It's just not a place for me. But we recently found a Reddit discussion that was kind of the opposite of that. Now, this discussion was about the quote-unquote unsettling places that everyone thinks you should avoid, all right? Now, some places were described simply as creepy. That would be Elgin, Kansas, Tonopah, Nevada, and Barstow, California. And they all have their own particular creep factor, as described by the people that contributed. Other places, well, some people think you should avoid them because they're, quote, post-apocalyptic. One person described a city as looking like the set of The Last of Us. That'd be places like Shreveport, Louisiana, East St. Louis, Illinois, and now, oh boy, what is this? Pitcher, Oklahoma. And then there's Central Pennsylvania. Now, I personally could rattle off 50 reasons not to go there, but one of the major reasons is that it's been on fire for the last 50 years. Seriously. Now, a lot of different places were brought up, and they were brought up for a lot of different reasons, but all of them bad. But today, we want to know the place that you would not recommend to anyone. It might be your own hometown, place you went to school, place you were stationed for a while, or just a place you stopped to get gas on your way to somewhere better. But today's question is, where is the last place on earth you'd recommend anyone going, and why?
To be a part of the Big Show, call 206-803-ROCK. You can like Men's Room on Facebook, follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Men's Room Live, and send your emails to themensroom@kisw.com.
Without the ones like you, who work tirelessly to keep things running, everything would suddenly stop. Hospitals, factories, schools, and power plants, they all depend on you. No matter the weather, emergency, or time of day, you're the ones who get it done. At Grainger, we're here for you with professional-grade industrial supplies. Count on real-time product availability and fast delivery. Call, clickgrainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance too with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance, and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at Progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
For those in the market for flavor, there's Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, a flavorful drink that's a modern twist on a Mexican street classic with four vibrant and refreshing flavors. Pineapple, watermelon, hibiscus, and cucumber lime. Made with a splash of real fruit juice. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas are perfect for any fiesta, small or big. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, boldly authentic, vibrantly flavorful. Drink responsibly. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas flavored beers imported by Crown Imports, Chicago, Illinois. Hibiscus contains juice only for color.
What's up?
Well, it's what's down that's got my attention.
Oh?
Yeah, look at that long snake.
Snake? Oh, traffic. Those are cars.
I know they're cars. I'm being metaphorical. If I were a human, I'd ride that Bel Air Airporter shuttle. Look at it. It gets you to SeaTac quickly. You can sleep, look out the window, be productive, and it's in the HOV. Hey, maybe it stands for heading on vacation.
Bel Air Airporter shuttle with 8 round trips daily. Click airporter.com to book your trip today.
The debauchery rolls on. You're listening to The Men's Room with Miles and Thrill. 99.9. KISW.
Oh, it's all the way we go. Welcome to season 19, episode number 4098. What a large and in charge program we have for you today. Guaranteed future repeat. Exciting return of Who Sucks Less. Steve, I don't know how you do it. You find people doing dumb things, stupid things in the news.
It's tough to do, man.
You bring us three of those stories each and every week. It is up to us to determine out of the three stories which one sucks the least. What are people up to this week on Who Sucks Less?
Mike put it best this morning. He said, man, you just went for the suck. And there's no other way to explain it. These are not the worst people on earth, but they suck somehow more. They're okay. Going to piss you off. Just know that.
Okay.
All right.
What else do we have for you today? Oh, yeah.
Sounds fun.
It does sound fun, doesn't
I'm
it?
I'm already pissed.
We have your tickets to see Metallica every day in May. Our chance to win is coming up at 4:20. Now, yeah. I think...
Miles, once again, I just want to remind you as we go through this, because I know you're tempted. Mm-hmm. So I want to be the voice of reason. Do not call it Metallica.
Yeah. That's correct.
All right. Yes. That came from the top. They said, don't call that. So I just want to make sure. You know, I know you get excited about this stuff. I don't mm-hmm. want you to call this Metallica.
I'm going to call this one wherever you may
Rome.
Oh.
Yeah. I see you did.
420 is the time. We will give you the code word, the secret word, and then you text that to 206-803-ROCK. Now, I believe, based on my previous performances,
yeah,
they have changed the way that the contest is working. So, since we have them all day long, every day, typically when we give away tickets, we say...
All May long?
We're going to give it all day. We
come on,
all
easy,
May
long. Man.
Oh, man.
This is not Maytallica. We're not playing into
it. No, it's just all day, all May.
All day, all May.
All day, all May.
Yeah.
What'd you say?
420 being the time, okay? But we are not going to give out the secret word. Because typically I will forget to give out the secret word. So what they have done is, I believe they have Malcolm, or Taz, one of our voice guys, actually giving the call to action, therefore eliminating me from messing up your opportunity to win tickets to Metallica.
That's called faking.
They did you a favor.
Yeah.
That way
they understand the flaw. We have a workaround.
Right. Now, my theory is...
As the kids say, they knew the assignment.
My theory is it makes you listen to the program longer because you're like, when is he eventually going to say it?
Mm-hmm.
That would be when I remember.
Yeah.
So, oh, yeah.
Yeah. Jesus. Make you listen longer for no reason. Yeah. Oh, what else we have? We have some updated locations.
He twisted that into, like, look what I'm doing for
exactly us. Right. More,
It was his whole plan, Mike.
That's
the secret sauce, brother.
He sat there for hours in that office concocting his plan.
Turn that corner out, baby. I mean, I haven't been radio that for that long for nothing. But,
why they make you the head of the table, Miles.
That's right, exactly. his stupid is actually genius. Updated locations on Men's Room IPA from Black Raven Brewing. We'll bring you some of those coming up as well. And today, whether it was a vacation, whether it was travel, whether it was work, maybe you spent a weekend someplace, maybe you drove through someplace, you could have been there for a week or two or a month, you might have been in the military.
Mm-hmm.
There's all kinds of reasons why we end up in different locations. For a lot of you, it's a job. Quite simply, if you need to go someplace or move, or maybe your work has you travel, you get to experience a lot of different places across the country and around the world.
Sure. Or if you're one of those people that, like my parents, if you're going to go somewhere, you're going to drive. So they have driven back and forth across this country, honestly, like countless times. You would think they're long-haul truckers, but every time I talk to them, there's a destination that they will have in mind. And they know the destination, they want to go there because they like it there. However, all of the little stops between their destination and home base kind of suck, man.
Oh, yeah.
And every time I visit my parent, I mean, she's got like 50 years of stories. Man, your father were driving here and the craziest people, the scariest people, the most racist people, the friendliest people. Whatever. But I mean, they could draw up an atlas of places not to visit in the United States if you don't need to.
I have a birthday in January. So out of my friend group, I had one of the first birthdays. So, I turned 21, then a couple of my buddies did in February, and we were all 21 at that point. So now instead of, we had been drinking, we'd been going to the bars locally that we knew we could go to, but we were going to make a road trip.
Sure.
And, somebody came up with the idea, hey, why don't we go to Atlantic City? We'll get a hotel room there. We'll gamble. Ooh. We'll spend the weekend. And at that point in time, you know, there's in the late, you know, this was 1990, 91. It was Atlantic City. I was not aware. I knew, obviously, Las Vegas is the Mac Daddy place to go gamble.
Sure, of course.
On the East Coast, we really did not have anything else other than Atlantic City. They were slowly popping up. I want to say maybe Wilmington, Delaware had a casino or gaming. Or
I don't know if they did yet.
Betting on the races.
They did not yet.
Okay, so that was it. And from what I knew, all right, there's a boardwalk in Atlantic City.
What else do you need to hear?
I've heard, you know, I've been to the boardwalk in Ocean City in Rehoboth. Actually, a good time vacation-wise that I have these memories of.
Right, and this is pre, like, tribal stuff, too.
Correct.
Yes.
The tribes did not have any casinos. You maybe had riverboat gambling, what is it, St. Louis or something like that, but you physically had to be on the boat in the Mississippi.
So we got a deal. The hotels were incredibly affordable. And you're staying, I think we stayed at the MGM or whatever it was, and we were on the boardwalk, on the beach, sounds like the greatest weekend in the world. We're 21 years old. Now we can go to any bar we want to.
Because the way they sold Atlantic City, now you found out different when you got there, but the sales pitch was, hey, when you lived on the East Coast, you know what Vegas is, man. Obviously, that's the gaming mecca, but why would you fly that far, dude? In less time than it takes you to fly there, you can drive.
Right.
No, but they sold it as picture Vegas, right? And you go like, okay, so you picture the strip. But instead of the desert, dude, it's the Atlantic Ocean. I mean, we got a beach. Yeah. It's Vegas. You go, oh, dude, that sounds great.
My one buddy was from Philly. He'd been to Vegas, but he had not been of drinking age.
Right.
So like anything else, we wanted to go. So we pack up our crap. It is about a five and a half hour drive. We pull into Atlantic City, and I cannot describe to you what, when we pulled up, what was going through my head. For about 3 miles in, before you get to Atlantic City starts to become Atlantic City, which I did not know what it was.
Mm-hmm.
And as far as depressed areas of New Jersey, you've heard of Camden, maybe. But Atlantic City, man, I've never been to Camden personally, so I can't quote on that, but I will tell you this. You have never seen anything in your life like driving into Atlantic City.
That's awful.
You cannot believe it. And then when you get there, I mean, we had a POS car that we were driving, and you still weren't sure if you wanted to risk your car being smashed.
It's still worth being stolen.
Exactly.
I mean, honestly.
So just to find a place to park, and we ended up parking it in the casino. We were going to park it out in the parking lot. My buddy's like, look, man, we're going to valet the car.
Yeah.
And I'm like, dude, it's like $10 a day or whatever it was. And he's like, I don't care. He's like, we are paying to valet the car.
Yeah.
He's like, we'll walk everywhere. We'll take cabs wherever you want to go.
Where all did you go? Did you take a cab in Atlantic City?
No.
Because when you leave the boardwalk, done.
I didn't know that. There's nowhere else to go. There really is not anywhere else.
You really shouldn't walk a few blocks away from the casinos.
And they will tell you that. Sure, even the casinos will tell you that. And they don't tell you that because they're going, oh, we want you to stay here. We're telling you this for your own health and safety.
Now, when you go to Vegas, obviously people smoke in casinos. One of those things. You can tolerate it or you can't. I'm a smoker at the time. The filtration systems in the casinos and in the gaming areas and everything else, they are not the same as they are now.
Correct.
People are smoking cigars. This is the...
Because you can still smoke indoors in general.
You got a lot of big dudes in there, and they're chiefing on cigars. I mean, you're basically walking through a cloud for two... You can smoke in the rooms. The whole place was like one gigantic ashtray. The games themselves were a little bit more antiquated. It would be the equivalent of going to Fremont in Vegas instead of playing.
Yeah, that's a good description.
Not that they don't have newer slots there, but you get the idea. Some of the old school games are in there. It was not terribly expensive, but there was always an element of danger. You know, even if you wanted to walk.
You don't just gamble at the casino. You gamble with your life. Like, welcome to Atlantic City.
I remember we walked a quarter of a mile or maybe a half mile on the boardwalk to another casino that was having some kind of like seafood buffet.
Okay.
On the way back was one of the sketchiest walks. It's a boardwalk. There's people out there. There's people working. There's people trying to get you to come in casinos. It's still terrifying.
Yeah. It's January. Because I went in December for my birthday when I turned 21. And it, same story.
Right.
I have no idea how bad that city sucked. Like, the casinos aren't as nice. We went to a very popular place that has good food and attractive women. Even that was the worst location of that I'd ever been to. Mm-hmm. Like, it absolutely sucked. We went to a strip club that sold beer. They don't even strip. They're just in bathing suits because Jersey has weird rules.
Right. Well, there's a lot of stuff going on outside of the casinos. Now,
yeah, crack.
When I went to Reno, Nevada, all right, I was going there to see Glenn Campbell and...
Sure, wasn't Glenn Cannon?
Yeah, Glenn Cannon and the Damage Done. Yeah. Glenn Campbell before he passed away. I went and saw him, and I saw another little kind of a punk hillbilly band called And the Devil Makes Three.
Okay.
So I was there for two shows and two nights. And pulling into Reno, and Reno, I can't put my finger on it. It's nothing like Atlantic City. Is there violence there? Is it dangerous? Maybe. I don't know. Could be. But it was just the element of, wow.
Just oddness?
Yeah, like, wow. This is, like, I wasn't joking when I said, like, this probably, Reno probably only has the only eye patch store in the United States of America. Because it just, nobody walked under their own power okay. You know, like, those... Everyone had some kind of a stick or cane.
Right,
Like, it was just like everyone, or you're walking with a limp. Everyone was wearing cowboy boots. There were horses tied up outside of the casino that I was staying at. People rode their horses to go game, and they were tied up out front. I'm like, this is, it was just, it wasn't that I would never say don't go there. it was just one of those things where I'm like,
I would almost say that
this is a different world.
Sure.
This is a completely different world. Now, I know when you get into suburban Reno, there are nice neighborhoods and all of those things. I was downtown.
Yeah.
So I was downtown by the Greyhound bus and the train station. If you know anything about any city in America,
that's not where you want to be.
You know that that obviously, I mean, Seattle's not too bad. Portland's not that bad as far as where the
if you cross the street here, it gets a lot worse, right?
Exactly.
I mean, like specifically where you are, no.
I mean, I like Reno better than Atlantic City, but yes. I've only stayed at the Peppermill, which is a nice casino and resort.
Trust Ted, yep. You do. You like Reno better than Atlantic City. Even if you stayed in a freaking tent, well, you like Reno better than Atlantic City.
I told you, man.
That's not even a contest.
Front desk. Where would you recommend, within just a couple blocks, where can we go and get the best meal around this area? You want to go down to the strip club by the train station. Do you like fish? And I'm like, is this a setup? Yes. Best sushi in town. So I'm like,
landlocked ass Reno.
Right.
Okay.
I'm like, okay. So we go down there. And I mean, it is, you walk through and it's freezing cold because that's where all the sushi stuff is being done.
Oh, right, right.
So it's all, and it's like 6-7 feet. There's like 3 sushi chefs back there. Then you walk down a set of steps, like 6 steps, and you are now in the dance area. So you kind of come down, like, but there's all these people in there eating sushi.
Are they legitimately eating sushi, or are they watching the girls, or both?
Both.
Okay.
Both. It was just, it's...
Yeah.
It was still one of the
I
most...
I still know the sushi is what I want at a strip club.
I'm telling you, it...
Was it good?
We did not eat there. I couldn't do it. Every single... Well, I mean, we have great sushi here. I want to go...
Yes.
I'm thinking I'm in Reno. I want to get a steak. Yeah. I want to get, like, you know, like, these guys are dressed like cowboys, like normal people.
Beef.
I figure, like, this is where I can get stew and, you know, cornbread or whatever, you know. Not sushi in the middle of the desert when it's 98 degrees outside. But, so, of course, I sit down there immediately. This chick's on my lap. And this is the last person you want on your lap. Out of 20 people. There are 19 that would have been acceptable.
Right? I know what you mean. That just sounds harsh.
And
the last girl you want in your lap.
No, yeah. And she wouldn't leave.
Of course not.
It was something going on. Like, hey, look, man, I'll buy you a drink. Like, you know, I'm just trying to see if I can talk to anybody other than you. But you got to understand, like, stripper on guard. You know what I mean? Like, she's...
Oh, yeah.
She found her territory, and she's lifted her leg. And
peed on her tree.
Nobody else coming over.
Not without a fight.
So after, like, 2 drinks, and, you know, I was thinking about moving up, and then I moved up to the front rail. Now, guess who follows me? You know,
oh God!
She follows me up. She sits right beside me. I'm just like, man, what is going on? Finally, got the hell out of there, man. And I mean, it just got weirder. Every single element got weirder.
What time of night was it?
I mean, it was the shows were 9 o'clock, so basically all day you're just kind of putzing around.
But I mean, when were you in the strip club?
Oh, in the strip club, that was Saturday afternoon.
Yeah.
Well, you get the afternoon girls, man. So yeah, that's, you know.
Yeah. And then
there's a reason everything's cheaper in the afternoon. Yeah. Movies, right. Strip club.
And
like,
then,
you know.
and then the venue for.
Yeah, if I'm in a strip club and it's daylight, it's because I haven't left.
The venue for The Devil Makes 3 was between Reno and Tahoe. So it's up on this big mountain. It's in a weird, I mean, there's something weird about Northern California.
Yeah, there's a lot of things weird about Northern California.
It's bizarre, but we go into this basically this roadhouse to see this show. And it's kind of like the same kind of roadhouse that we ducked in.
Outside of Denver,
which is just like, whoa, man. Because basically when we walked in there, we said, all right, just go back to back and don't stop swinging.
That was our entire conversation was, hey, man, we're still outside. Look, if it comes to it, back to back, throw haymakers, and then we'll just circle back and meet at the hotel.
Right.
That was our whole plan. We went in. They couldn't have been nicer. Great people.
And when I walked into this venue, man, I could not believe it. It was like an entire hippie commune. People are smoking weed in here. They don't care. The women, never seen a razor. The guys, never had a haircut. Half the time you walk by with somebody, go, oh, my God, was that you? Because you couldn't believe the body odor.
Right, right.
It was just bizarre, man. I can't explain to you what a bizarre. I came back home that weekend, and I was just like, that might be the weirdest combination of crap.
Well, look, I like Devil Makes 3, but that is definitely like a festival kind of almost country jam band.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, I didn't know what to expect, but they were great. Don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
Just the whole time, I'm just like, man, this is bizarre. Where is the last place on earth that you would recommend anyone going and why? 206-803-ROCK.
At Metro, get an iPhone 12 with 5G and a dual camera system for $99.99. Take amazing pictures and share them instantly. And don't put up with life's yada yada.
Yada yada.
Like photo bombers. Zoom, crop out,
yada yada,
and bye.
You don't take yada yada in life, don't take yada yada from your wireless provider. Get iPhone 12 with 5G with no activation fees and nada yada yada. Only at Metro by T-Mobile. Switch to Metro, bring your ID. This offer isn't available for customers currently at T-Mobile or that have been with Metro in the past 180 days.
You've probably heard about generative artificial intelligence, but are you vigilant to its exploitability? Generative AI is shaping society and transforming our daily lives. While we want to embrace the potential, we must also set the standards for responsible use and safeguard the future of our digital world. HackerOne employs over 2 million plus ethical hackers, 750 of them specializing in prompt hacking and other AI security and testing. The creative approach taken by a diverse pool of ethical hackers is the best way to discover vulnerabilities. When launching new AI deployments, let HackerOne's AI red teaming address the novel challenges of AI safety and security for your business. AI innovation can only be effective if models are tested for safety and security issues that could cause harm. Make sure your AI models and deployments can't be tricked into providing information beyond their intended use, and that security flaws can't be exploited to access confidential data or systems with HackerOne. Learn more about our AI red teaming today at hackerone.com/AI.
eBay Motors is here for the ride. Remember when you first saw the potential? And then through some elbow grease, fresh installs, and a whole lot of love, you transformed 100,000 miles and a body full of rust into a drive that's all your own. Look to your left. Look to your right. It's official. No one's got a ride like this. There's nothing else that sounds like, feels like, or looks like the set of wheels in your garage. With over 122 million parts, you can make sure your number one ride or die stays running smoothly, so there's no limit to how far you can take it. Brake kits, turbochargers, engines, exhaust kits, roof racks, LED headlights, bumpers, whatever your baby needs, eBay Motors has it. And with eBay Guaranteed Fit, it's guaranteed to fit your ride the first time, every time, or your money back. Plus at these prices, well, you're burning rubber, not cash. Keep your ride or die alive at ebaymotors.com. Eligible items only. Exclusions apply.
99.9 KISW. The shenanigans continue. This is the Men's Room with Miles and Thrill.
Tonopah, Nevada. The clown motel next to a cemetery full of infants and workers who died in a silver mine.
Yeah.
When I got there, the owner of the clown motel upgraded me for free when I stayed to the room where he keeps the paintings of clowns that he paints himself.
Why? I think that's why he upgraded him, the hope that he can sell one of these.
Get there, yeah, you need to drive a few hours of pure desert and pass the Area 52 nuclear testing site. They ended up barely sleeping because every hour on the hour, there were insane stomping and walking back and forth noises from the room above us for about 10 to 15 minutes. My friend thought it was the owner trying to scare us, but eventually we figured out it was probably ghost hunters or something. Stayed one night in a casino hotel down the street from the clown motel. Seriously creepy. It reminded me of The Shining. Our question, where is the last place on earth that you would recommend anyone going and why? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Chris. Welcome to the men's room.
Hola. So, sorry if I'm a little slow. I'm sick today, but anyway. Don't go to Indio, California if you ever don't get the chance.
I've heard that, but
where they, where they have Coachella?
Yeah, it's right next to Coachella.
All right, let me ask you this. Other than Coachella, is there any reason to visit there?
For us Seattleites, there's only one other reason, and that's because that's where the Kraken minor team affiliate is, the Firebirds.
Ah, okay.
Well, I mean, Indio is basically like Palm Springs, right?
Well, where you're talking about, that's basically La Quinta. So Indio is a little bit south of there.
Okay.
So you could definitely play golf there. You can spend your days in the sun there. You can go swimming there. Most people play pickleball all the time. But from that area, the worst rap I've heard is 29 Palms.
Well, sure.
But that's north of there.
And that's a military installation.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Right. I don't know about that.
I'll tell you what, man. Great Mexican food.
Why did you spend time in India? Are you from there?
Excuse me. My kids live down there. My kid's mom moved down there. She dragged me along. I lasted there for about 3 months.
Is that what ended the relationship?
No, it's also wicked hard because, I mean, it's just California in general. It's just wicked hard to find a job. So I have to
summers are brutal.
Myself back up to Washington.
Yep. Well, summers are brutal, too.
I've not heard anything good about Indio outside of Coachella, right? I mean, well, I get.
That's a sprawling area, so it's slowly creeping outward. But I'll tell you what, the Firebirds, mm-hmm. their arena is gorgeous.
Sure.
They're good. It's amazing. I mean, it really is. It's the only thing about that area is it smells like a litter box.
Oh, okay, no. Cool.
I can't describe it.
But like an ammonia smell?
The water is... Okay, water is a precious commodity.
Sure.
But you can't really drink that water.
Mm.
And the water that's out there is just like, I don't know, it's just, it has this stench to it. If it's...
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then the ground cracks and it's got that smell to it like a riverbed.
I mean, it's the desert.
Yes.
Well, yeah.
I mean, you know what I mean? Like, we're used to Palm Springs and that stuff, but it's like, it is still the desert.
It is.
I think Ted nailed it best earlier. We're talking in the office. We said, you realize with a lot of the major universities, right, if you take the major university out of that city... That is not a place you would ever want to visit. Like, we have UW, people will still come to Seattle. You go find UCLA, like, I get it, you're in Los Angeles, but Michigan, you're not going there. Maybe you go to Columbus, Ohio. It's not a bad place, there's just not much to do, but...
I mean, look, I grew up with it, right? I mean...
Yeah, College Park,
like, part of the reason College Park stayed a little bit better than the rest of the county in the 80s and 90s, because the university was there.
The school, so you
but
can
I also
still
lived
do business.
Next to Greenbelt,
right.
Which was terrible, and ghetto, or... Laurel, right? But, like, yeah, College Park was a little insulated because you have the university.
But, I mean, think about it. The ones in Kansas, like, you're not going to these cities at the universities. Even Baton Rouge, right?
Oh, I forgot about Baton Rouge.
Would you visit Baton Rouge?
No.
If the
it was awful.
That's what
outside
I mean.
Side of the LSU football game and tailgate. Okay.
That's what I'm saying.
Awful.
You take these colleges, and it's just amazing because as long as the colleges are there, you will still have some industry, right? You can get bars, you can get restaurants, all the things that go along with it, places to buy clothing, et cetera, et cetera. You take those colleges out of there, and it's like, dude, no offense. You live in an S-hole.
Yeah. Here you go, Shreveport is like The Last of Us at night. I spent a week there for work training a few years ago. I thought the place was oddly cool. Much of it was a dystopian wasteland, but you'll find small pockets of people working hard to try to resurrect the place. Got a room in one of the casinos, which was odd, too. $50 a night, and it was a really nice room because I was there during the week when the place was empty. It wasn't a bad experience, except for the smell of pee whenever you left the casino to go to your car. And then you drive past the Hustler Club and the Stripper Supply Superstore on the way to training every day. I was born and raised in Shreveport, but like you said, everything about it is true. I just don't... I don't like hearing other people say it, said one resident.
Well, of course. I mean, that's fair.
I mean, that's the way it is, right? Like, wherever you're from, right? Like I look, I mean, I lived in Baltimore for, what, 3 or 4 years?
Mm-hmm.
So I could talk a little bit about it,
sure.
But like, right, I mean, you hear other people just S it on for no reason. It's like, all right, hang on.
Right.
It's like with your buddies. Now, I can make fun of you, but like, if I don't know you, you don't get to chime in.
Agreed. Yeah. Agreed.
Where's the last place on earth that you would recommend anyone going and why? 206-803-ROCK.
Just want to throw in a local one real quick. Aberdeen, Washington.
Aberdeen. Have I been to Aberdeen?
You ever been Ocean Shores?
I don't believe so.
So you've probably driven through Aberdeen. It's where Kurt Cobain is from.
Oh, God. Yeah, no, I have not been there.
Yeah.
I've never, other than Kurt Cobain being from there, no bright lights on Aberdeen.
It's remote, yeah.
Is it that bad?
Yes. I've driven up that peninsula, up and down that many times, going across the Astoria Bridge. Every time I drive through there, I think the same thing. I cannot believe that Chris Novoselic lives out here.
Or he chooses to, right?
Yes. He's got
a farm.
He's got tons of property and all that. But once you get out in the middle of nowhere, I mean, you're thinking, like, where... If you need to fly someplace, you know, the Foo Fighters call and say, hey, man, Smear and the guys are getting together. We're going to play some Nirvana song. Come on down. Where do you go? Do you drive to SeaTac?
What other options do you have?
What I'm saying is, do you drive to Portland? Because it's going to be 2 or 3 hours just to be able to get out of town.
Sure.
I mean, I'll say the same thing about Coos Bay, Oregon. Look, I had a great time with my family down there, but we were riding quads on the sand dunes that were out there.
Right.
As far as exploring town, you can go to a museum or go back to your hotel.
What is the museum?
A boat museum. It's a maritime museum. Mm-hmm. It's right beside the casino.
Okay.
You know,
which is right beside the strip club.
And they have like aquariums down there if you want to. And they got the Family Fun Center where you can go play putt-putt. That's about it.
Okay.
But it's
like a town that size on the coast, the better option is Astoria. Every time. You don't have to drive nearly as far as Coos Bay, but as far as a waterfront community, that's pretty cool elements to it.
And there's a handful of those towns where you drive through, and I like, no disrespect, but it's like, how is this town still alive?
How do you exist? What is your industry?
Lumber.
What
lumber.
Do people do?
Lumber.
But that's why they're so down. Like, we were talking about some of those towns in PA and Western Maryland when the coal mining stopped. So I think that same thing with Aberdeen. I think it was a sprawl, like a good-sized city, but like when all the lumber and like Weyerhaeuser leaves, it's like, all right, what do you got now?
Nothing.
Mm-hmm. Where is the last place on earth that you would recommend anyone going and why? 206-803-RON.
And Kurt was always a ray of sunshine.
Yes.
That's right.
Just listen to his music. Hello, Cheyenne. Welcome to the men's room.
Hola, gentlemen.
Hola.
So, oddly enough, the place that I would recommend that no one go is the place I am right now, South Dakota. It is a place where people, even though it's common sense that apparently it's not so common, that one should not try to pet bison. They do, and then they get horned and lose their pants. And then also, our governor actually gave us a state slogan that said meth. We're on it, so yeah.
Oh, God, I remember that.
Meth.
I think she was the shot of the day, or whoever it was at the time. Yeah, that was
meth,
one of our shots of the day.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. All right.
Yeah, it's pretty awful.
I mean, look, the most famous thing is either Sturgis or Mount Rushmore, right?
Yeah, and the thing I would say about Mount Rushmore, having lived here all my life, like, it looks suspiciously to me like a monument to the Golden Girls.
All right. Okay,
that's pretty good.
Damn, man, I'm never gonna not see that now.
Yeah, exactly. And I mean, if you're not a certain kind of person, like, it's hard to find a job. Like me, I'm pretty famous in the music scene because I sing, but other than that, I just have, like, people will buy me a beer, but it's hard to find a job as a disabled person, so that sucks, too. So.
Well, yeah, fair enough.
Okay.
Probably tough anyway, but I think South Dakota even tougher.
I like this one. I stopped in Coeur d'Alene, Idaho, on a road trip for about two years ago, downtown doing a little sightseeing on foot, and I approached a four-way intersection. Three matching black SUVs pulled up to the stop sign, blackout tinted windows, and full-length Punisher logos on their hoods. The lead car stopped, and someone on the passenger side rolled their window down just far enough that I could see a ball cap and a pair of sunglasses. Then I got stared down for a few seconds, and they drove on. The whole experience felt so far off, I went back to my car and left. Later, I did a little internet search on the town and found out the Aryan Nations compound, arsons, attacks on businesses, and the America First white supremacists were still in operation in the area.
Yeah, they're still in operation in the area. Are you kidding me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Where is the last place on earth you'd recommend anyone going, and why? 206-803-RUN.
Look, I will crap on Idaho, but I told you, like, people go, well, you're from Washington. It's like, well, I have a lot of friends in Montana, and as soon as you cross over there, they're not big on it either.
Right.
Whereas, like, as a Marylander, I hate on Virginia, but, like, people from North Carolina don't have a huge beef with Virginia.
No.
It's just kind of us. It's like, that's one of the few states I know where everybody on the other side of it's like, ugh.
Yeah, both sides are like, yeah, we don't like you. A couple from the text says, one place I would not recommend ever visiting, and they're right, I made the mistake of doing this, Gary, Indiana. Nothing but crack, horse-laced drugs, and gang violence. No thank you, not even to pass through, just avoid it. That's not a joke. It's not even, just don't do it. Someone else says, hola, I'm in the Coast Guard. I was sent to Lockport, Louisiana 3 months after Hurricane Ida went through. The hotel was totally not moldy, that's in quotes, and rooms were still being cleaned while we were there. We could still see hurricane damage everywhere, and my only food options were a Sonic that was open 50% of the time and a Taco Bell that was open less than that. I will leave the service before I get sent back to the bayou.
Speaking of Gary, here's one on Gary. My uncle used to drive delivery trucks across the Midwest in the 70s. He told me stories of Gary, Indiana. The best was the sign he would pass going into Gary. It stated, welcome to Gary, the lowest paid police force per capita with the highest murder rate per capita. Enter at your own risk.
Yeah, that's a sales pitch right there.
Where's the last place on earth you'd recommend anyone going, and why? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Andy. Welcome to the men's room.
Hola.
Hola.
All right, so when I was a kid, my stepdad, his family, he grew up in Kosciuszko, Mississippi.
Where in Mississippi is that? North, south, east, west, what?
You know, I looked it up a couple of years ago. It's about an hour away from Jackson, but I don't know if it's north or south.
Okay.
It's the middle of nowhere, and one, I would just recommend nobody ever go to Mississippi, just period. But Mississippi, this town, they lived on a catfish pond, and that was the first time down there. We were down there fishing, and I'm like, Ted, I don't do snakes very well.
Mm-hmm.
And I look into the pond, and I see this thing swim in. I'm like, what is that? It gets probably about 20 feet away, and then it pops its head up, and now it's swimming on top of the water, just coming right at us. So that was the last time I went fishing in that pond. And one time, you guys remember in like the 80s, 90s, they had those little kiddie pools that they were like collapsible. They had like the whales and dolphins and stuff.
Yeah.
The blue ones, yeah.
Yeah, so we had one of those. That was me and my sister's entertainment. That was the pool we got to swim in when it's 95 degrees out. And my sister shoves me out of it, and I just start crying. I'm bawling my eyes out, screaming, and my mom's sitting on the porch, and she's telling me to suck it up. She's like, she just pushed you. Just get up. And what she failed to realize is I had fallen into an entire fire ant nest. Fire ants crawling all over my arm, back is biting the crap out of me.
Well, it sounds like you just had some bad outdoor experiences with the wild, more so. I realize what you're saying.
He said Mississippi.
You could have just hung up after that, bro.
Look, the only place I've ever been there is Biloxi, and Biloxi is not, it's not great. It's not the worst, though.
It's not the worst. It's not good. The only thing I give Mississippi, honestly, is the food. I don't think it's worth visiting Mississippi for the food, but if you do find yourself there, definitely eat.
Yeah. Well, that was my nature experiences. That was also the first time in my life, I think it was probably 8 or 9, and we were walking in just a grocery store, and that was the first time I had ever heard the N-word used with the hard R just casually thrown out in conversations. And I look at my mom, and I'm just like, where the hell are we?
Mississippi, son.
Well, I've heard it in Florida.
I've heard it everywhere. I've never been to a place where I have, at least not in this country, I've never been to a place where I have not heard it. Mississippi is just more prevalent because they're very open about it. You know, other people might mutter it when I walk by. But yeah, Mississippi, I mean, that's
hey, look, man, it's the only state that gives West Virginia a run for the bottom.
That's it. One of the other texts came in here. It says, I would recommend no one ever take a cruise. Normally, I would agree with you. But I will say this. I would not do one of the Caribbean cruises or the Alaska cruise. Put it this way. I would not do a cruise because, again, I'm not like a resort kind of person. I can't just be stuck with the same people all the time. I will lose my ass. So my friends convinced me years ago to take a cruise. I was vehemently against it. But the cruise they sold me on, it's a European cruise, but the difference was they said, look, man, we know you're not going to like everyone on the boat. We know how you are. This is not good for you. But on this cruise, 7-day cruise, 6 days in a row, you're in a different port of call. And the way they timed it out, you go to bed. When you wake up, you're in a different city. Get back on the boat about 6, eat dinner, hit the casino, get drunk, go back to bed. When you wake up, you're in a different city. So every day, I could get off the boat. My worst day on that cruise, and it wasn't a bad day, but my worst day was the last day of it. They have to make time to go back to the initial protocol so that one day you were stuck on the boat. And, man, after like 3 hours, I started losing my mind. You know, like I said,
there's just nowhere to go.
Well, there's nowhere to go. And it's just allowed, like I said, resort people aren't necessarily the types of people I want to be hanging out with. Apparently, whether it's U.S. or Europe, that was my experience. But if you're someone that does not like being trapped in that situation, I would recommend either the European cruise, only because I know the countries are so close together that, like I said, every day you get off the boat and you see something new. But I hate the idea of a vacation where I'm like, I sat in a metal can and I didn't do anything.
I looked
at the water.
I like cruises.
Do you like cruises?
I do, man. I've been on 2 in my lifetime.
Where did you go?
Both are down the Caribbean area. I would love to do the European cruise.
How long are you on the boat?
A full week.
There was no place to get off the boat.
Sometimes it's 2 days to like just to get to Jamaica,
right.
To get to Montego Bay.
The first day is you're on the water getting down there, and you know then the day after day you're stopping at different
ports. All right, I can live with
that. So the day leading in and the day leading out you're on the water. Every other day you're at a new port of call every day.
I can survive that.
Right, and it honestly I don't mind it. I just sit
the
there
only
and drink
the only boat I don't mind being on is a fishing boat.
Here's the difference.
if we didn't know Thrill, he would be annoyed with us. We'd be like, hey, buddy, we're heading down to the bar. Come on, man. Like, I'm smoking a cig. Yeah, we'll wait right here for you.
Until you're done, buddy.
A couple others, guys. I've traveled to many cities.
With those two.
I've traveled to many cities for business. Every city has some redeeming qualities. Having said that, my least favorite places in the United States include Spokane, Washington.
Doubt. Agreed.
Amarillo, Texas.
Don't know it.
Wichita, Kansas, and Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. Amarillo, it's where you get the 72-ounce steak, right?
I just got to be there by morning.
Yeah. Dundalk, Maryland. Lived there for 2 months. Oh. What a dump.
Oh, Dundalk does suck.
It really is bad. Brother, there's not. Look, people beef on Baltimore, and Baltimore's earned that right. Dundalk basically borders Baltimore. You go to Dundalk, Baltimore strikes you, like you said, like going to Palm Springs.
My big four, Johnstown, Pennsylvania, El Paso, Texas, Cumberland, Maryland, and Yelm, Washington. Roanoke, Virginia, lived there for 3 years, hated it, no culture, no charm. New Orleans, French Quarter smells like dead fish, horse urine, and human vomit.
It does.
It does.
And Mobile, Alabama.
We're not going to deny it.
Mobile is full of crackheads. My dad was getting harassed at a gas station, and this guy was covered in scabs and had no teeth, and my mama almost had to use her concealed carry at a public gas station.
Yeah, I was in Birmingham at one point, and there was just nothing there.
Ain't no ham like Birmingham, is what they say.
And there's a reason for that.
Again, I would go to Alabama or Mississippi for college football.
Yep.
Where is the last place on earth that you would recommend anyone going, and why? 206-803-ROCK.
For those in the market for flavor, there's Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, a flavorful drink that's a modern twist on a Mexican street classic with four vibrant and refreshing flavors. Pineapple, watermelon, hibiscus, and cucumber lime, made with a splash of real fruit juice. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas are perfect for any fiesta, small or big. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, boldly authentic, vibrantly flavorful. Drink responsibly. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas flavored beers imported by Crown Imports, Chicago, Illinois. Hibiscus contains juice only for color.
Without the ones like you, who work tirelessly to keep things running, everything would suddenly stop. Hospitals, factories, schools, and power plants, they all depend on you. No matter the weather, emergency, or time of day, you're the ones who get it done. At Grainger, we're here for you with professional-grade industrial supplies. Count on real-time product availability and fast delivery. Call, clickgrainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance, too, with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance, and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
What's up? It's your boy, The Ted Smith from The Men's Room. And did you know I have a podcast? Well, I do. The Podcast. New episodes uploaded every Wednesday on the Odyssey app.
99.9 KISW. We return to the men's room with Miles and Thrill.
Metallica tickets coming up at 4:20. You'll hear the secret word. And then you text that word to 206-803-ROCK.
But you don't have to wait for Miles to say it. That's how we know this is going to work.
Yes. Tickets every single day in May.
Every day.
We're calling it Wherever I May Roam.
But not Metallica. It's very important that no one call this Metallica.
420
is when we'll give you that secret word.
But wherever you may roam.
Oh, here's a couple on the place you would never recommend anyone going. Not that you wouldn't want to go there at a normal time, but New Year's Eve at Times Square.
No.
4 hours of standing in the cold next to strangers so you can see a little blip drop from 10 blocks away.
I think that one's more just to say that you have been. But every time I see Times Square on New Year's Eve, I always think the same thing. God, I'm glad I'm not there.
No, I think they look freezing. It's cold as hell. And to the guy's point, Mike, I think you made a good point. You can say you've done it.
Right.
Somebody says, would you do it again? You say, hell no.
No. Absolutely. I tell you what, I had a great time on New Year's Eve in Las Vegas. They put on a hell of a fireworks show on top of a number
of different casinos. You start turning around, man. They're going off everywhere around you. So that's a pretty cool experience. They shut down the drag so you can walk. No cars are allowed.
I haven't been there on New Year's Eve, but same thing at the F1 race. Like after the race, after they announced the winners, there was fireworks all around.
Cool. Crater of Diamond State Park in Arkansas. It's the only diamond mine in the world, supposedly, where the public can look for diamonds.
Mm-hmm.
We went because my oldest son was into rocks at the time. It is a big open dirt field with a bunch of people there looking like the crowd you might see at the slot machines at a really depressing casino. Another one, Amarillo, Texas. Cold as F, hot as F. Isn't close to anything nice. Ocean, lake, river, nothing. Flat, dusty. Damn. No culture. Went to Toledo, Ohio for a job interview for my dream job. I realized that weekend that having my dream job wasn't actually that important to me.
Toledo is one. I've never been there.
Mm-hmm. I've driven through it.
Thank you. We drove by it on our way up to Ann Arbor, and I remember, and it's middle of the day, and I just went, oh my God, that place looks horrible.
And it's really crazy, man, because look, Lake Erie is beautiful on the north side of Ohio. It really is. All of the towns that should be beautiful waterfront property
aren't.
They are not.
They really aren't.
Where is the last place on earth that you would recommend anyone going and why? 206-803-ROCK.
You know, my wife texted me earlier, hearing what we're talking about today, she says, have you made fun of my hometown yet? No, listen. There's nothing inherently wrong with her hometown. It's the problem of getting there, all right? So it is a small, middle-of-nowhere city. And it's not even a city, right? But it still has a bunch of Victorian houses and all this kind of thing. There's a little bit going on there. There's a decent park that's on a waterfront. You can get things that you need. It's not the worst place. And for the most part, the people are fairly decent. Although I will say, to give you an idea of how few black people are in this particular city, my wife and I are, seriously, okay, we are eating lunch.
They say when you land, they're like, hey, Steve.
Basically, man, we're sitting in a restaurant. My wife and I just get lunch, all right? We're sitting at this restaurant, and there's a table of three older women. They keep looking over at us. And they look friendly. They're kind of smiling. Whatever. We end up going back to her mom's house. Maybe 6 hours later, one of the women from that table shows up at my mother-in-law's house. Okay? But understand this. This woman has known my wife her entire life. Because that's how it is in that town. Everyone has grown up there. Mm-hmm. This woman's known her entire life. Her entire life. But she did not recognize my wife. But she told me when I see her later at the house, she says, I thought that you were Mary's son-in-law. I go, why is that? She goes, because I've been over here before, and I saw a family picture. And then when I saw you in the restaurant, so I just stopped her and said, if you see my black ass and you think it's me in this mm-hmm. town, it's me. You can't go wrong. But that said, still not that bad of a place. However, on the way there, there's a place called Lancaster, Pennsylvania, and there's a lot of reasons to hate it. It is a dump. It's an awful place. But years ago, my friend's parents, they had retired, and they're going to open a used bookstore. This has been their plan for like 10 years, so good for them. They finally got around to it, and they're going to open it on literally Main Street in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. And they threw me and one of their sons a couple of bucks to help them move a bunch of books up there. So what they did is they're retiring. They went to all the public libraries. They said, what are the books you're going to get rid of? And believe, I mean, the libraries are like, here, take this. So we had a U-Haul full of used books.
And all right.
That's going to be their supply when they first open. All right, no problem. We didn't want to do it. I had been to Lancaster before. It's not a place I ever wanted to go back to. But again, you're paying us. It's like an hour and a half drive. Whatever. We'll do it. So it's just me and their son. We're driving this U-Haul up there. We're on 95. Well, wouldn't you know it, the U-Haul overheats. And we're both pissed because we're like, you've got to be kidding me, man. Pull up to the side of the road, pop the hood, let the steam come out, and we actually did end up peeing in the radiator. We're like, we just need to get where we're going. So pee in the radiator. But this held us back by a little bit over an hour. I did not realize that was fortunate for me. So we get back in the truck. We finally get to Lancaster. We're kind of annoyed because, again, this is not something we feel like doing, but whatever. We're going to help you folks out. And when we get there, we get to actual Main Street. There's not a ton of people on the street, and there's like yellow, looks like crime tape. And there's a few people milling around. We pull the truck in front of their soon-to-be-open shop. And everyone that walked by me is just giving me this really weird look. And then a cop starts walking down the street towards us. And we're unloading books at this point and taking them in. And the cop's like, what are you doing here, man? I said, we are unloading books for a future use bookstore. It's going to open there. And he kind of smiles and goes, I don't know if you knew this or not, ma'am, but there was a Klan rally on this very street. Oh, yeah, on Main Street. It ended like 45 minutes ago.
So it looks like you're doing the ultimate power move here.
It really did. Well, at that point, oh, yeah. All right, then I start flexing, but he's like, dude, it ended like 45 minutes ago. I'm like, are you being serious? He goes, yeah, man, honest to God. I said, okay, that explains why everyone's looking at me. He's like, you look crazy, like, F all of you. Kind of. So that's not it at all. I mean, yeah, F all of you, but that's not what the move here was. I'm just helping these guys move books. And then we told him, we said, dude, the radiator overheated on the way up here. That actually held us back by like an hour. He's like, you would not have wanted to have been here an hour ago. I'm like, you're right. And he said it was the full-on parade, all the people that are celebrating.
Bouncy houses for the
which
kids.
Which is the worst. It's not even that the Klan's going to do what the Klan does. I don't care, right? But it's more of the general population that's lining the side of the street in support of them was my issue. And I'm like, Jesus Christ, man.
Where is the last place on earth that you would recommend anyone going and why? 206-803-ROCK.
Haven't been back, by the way.
I mean, my buddy DB, his wife grew up in that area, so he's not that far from Lancaster.
Was it like Red Lion or something like that?
He's in one of those towns, but they have a very nice house. It's kind of out in the country, and then there's like little town centers and stuff, but it's not that far from like King of Prussia and all that stuff. But like, I'm with you. Like, driving back down to Maryland, I took some roads, and I'm just like, ugh.
It is bad.
And that's Amish country.
And that's the other weird thing about Pennsylvania, that part of Pennsylvania, like kind of south central and southeastern Pennsylvania. If you're not from there, you don't really know what all the signs are talking about. They're just town names. But it's Jim Thorpe, Red Lion, King of Prussia. It's nothing like, you know, Montgomeryville. They just have these weird-ass names. People are like, what is that? I'm like, they are cities that are here, man.
They have Dutch Wonderland.
They do.
Where is the last place on earth that you would recommend anyone going and why? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Steven. Welcome to the men's room.
Hola.
Hola.
Well, a place called Karachi, Pakistan.
I've heard of it.
I was there in 87 on a cruise when I was in the Navy. And you have to park the carrier like way, way out, 5 miles out. So you take one little boat to get close, and you get to another one, and you're getting inside the harbor. The stench of the harbor just hits you.
What does it smell like? Is it sewage or what?
Well, the dead animals on the side of the harbor there is why you start realizing this is why this place stinks so bad.
Oh.
It's ungodly. So you're there. I said, well, you know what? I want to go see some sights. So I got in a cab, and I said, take me to a zoo. I go to the zoo, and I said, I don't want to go to the zoo now because all the animals in there are dead.
Are you serious?
I'm dead serious.
I mean, you look through the cages and it's just a dead animal.
Did you have to pay to get in there?
I didn't go that far. I went about like 20, 25 feet into it and turned around and walked right back out because the animals right there at the front of the zoo were dead. And I said, I don't want to go look at a bunch of dumb dead animals.
Wow.
No.
Take me to a museum.
I was just about to say that, right? That's when you go to a museum.
Yeah, see the dead ones.
You go to a zoo because they're supposed to be alive. That's the key part of the zoo.
That is actually the very key to the zoo, is that they are safely enclosed and they are alive and kicking. How much time did you spend there?
Oh, we were there for a few days.
A few days? And you would never go back?
I would never go back.
All expenses paid trip, first class, you still say.
How was the food?
That was probably about the only good thing about the whole place.
I can believe it.
Chinese food. The best Chinese food I've ever had was in Karachi, Pakistan.
It's made from those dead animals at the zoo.
Hmm. Okay. Where is the last place on earth that you'd recommend anyone going and why? 206-803-ROCK.
I did not see that one coming.
Me neither. Greatest pizza I've ever had.
Yeah, greatest Chinese food. Pakistan.
Somebody here on the text line nails it. Says Niagara Falls, New York is an asshole. Niagara Falls, Ontario is awesome. And it is insane. Correct. If you're on the Canadian side, right, they kind of built it up. And they built it up a little more over the years. And it's still a tourist trap, but there's crap to do. And actually, the town that's kind of behind it seems like a decent place to live. And then you walk over, was it the Rainbow Bridge, Friendship Bridge, whatever it is. You go to the other side, man, and you're like, how are you this close to each other? And both of you rely on the same falls, essentially, to generate income. And New York State's like, we're not dropping a dime on this
asshole. The United States side is like Ripley's, believe it or not.
And that's the best place.
Tchotchke stores everywhere.
It's like a boardwalk.
It's awful. It is awful.
Where's the last place on earth that you'd recommend anyone going and why? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Bradley. Welcome to the men's room.
Hola.
Hola.
Paso, Wapato. Wapato, Washington, over by Yakima there. It's just, oh, man, it's nice to tell you what.
Now, are you, is it?
I'm to go to the see a Third Eye Blind concert just recently, and I go there and we find out that it's a dry county, so you can't even drink there or do nothing, which is what we pretty much planned on doing the whole weekend. We went, we smashed out the Wapato to basically, you know, hit one of the only bars that are out there, and dude, I'll tell you what, it was like the Twilight Zone, and we walked into this bar, and it's basically like hitting a record scratch, and all these people just staring at us, like the lighting is just beaming on us, and it was so weird, but I mean, just standing out in the parking lot, you already got all this, like six homeless people sitting there staring at us, with no street lights and nothing, and I mean, we were pretty sure we were going to get robbed. Like, it was just a sketchy freaking area, you know what I mean? It looks like some post-apocalyptic. man, it was weird, but yeah, I would definitely wouldn't recommend going back out there.
there's some small little towns in eastern Washington that are interesting.
They are definitely their own thing. Yes. And to me, before that, it was always central Pennsylvania. To me, it had the weirdest little towns.
Allentown's terrible. Johnstown's terrible. Harrisburg's terrible. Altoona's terrible. Shenandoah sucks.
But compared to some of the eastern Washington places, I'm like, okay, maybe central PA kind of has it going on some level. It doesn't. But, man, comparatively speaking, I don't know.
Some people might know this town. If you've ever been to Burning Man, depending on the route you take, but Cedarville, California.
All right.
I would only know it because you're up in the mountains in Northern California trying to get down to Nevada, right? But, I mean, it's literally like a stop sign. There's like one or two stores. There's one gas station where everybody stops at. But the first year I went in 14, it still had an old hotel that looked like cowboys would stay at, you know, with like the deck up top. I mean, it was the crappiest room I stayed in my life. But me and my buddy are like, well, we got a room. Let's go down to the little bar. And same thing. You walk in there because there's like a restaurant side. Then there's the bar side. We sit in the restaurant side. Let's go to the bar. Record scratch, cowboys, Spurs, hats. They are not happy to see us. And they're, like, they're making jokes, put some light up stuff outside. That'll get the hippies to come in. This part of California was probably not even a state during the Civil War.
Right.
Giant Confederate flag. My buddy's like, just don't say anything. I'm like, I don't know if I can let it go. And I mean, people, like, we tried to talk to like two people. The bartender was cute enough. She made like some joke with us. We got the look from these guys. It was just like, don't talk to her anymore. They're going to kick our ass. That was one where I was legit like, ooh, I don't know if we're going to make it out of here.
I've had two places where I felt like the record scratch, right? And one, we didn't stay there long. We literally just wanted to buy like some sodas and chips because we're doing a road trip thing. Me and my buddy Hollywood. And it was, I cannot remember the town of Virginia. It might be like Danville, Virginia or something. Super tiny, but it's at night, and nothing's open except the 7-Eleven. It was not a 7-Eleven. It's like a mom-and-pop shop, but essentially a 7-Eleven. And we walked in, and I just remember it was clearly an immediate family in there together, and it looked like mom was working the cashier. I think dad's just there to talk to his wife and their two kids, who are maybe 13, 14 years old. And when we opened the door, because there's no one else in there, they just turned around and looked at us. And they didn't look angry. They did not look displeased. And we couldn't say anything to each other until we got back into the car. But I said, man, was it just me or could we have fit like seven more eyes between her two eyes? And it was the whole family. It was so bizarre. And I don't know if it's inbreeding. I don't know if they literally related to lizards. I mean, it was like, it was jarring, man. But you couldn't just like pop your mouth open right. Like, Jesus,
what happened to your face?
But the only other time, man, and it was this rural ass place, Pennsylvania again. What's the ski joint up there? The Honeymoon? Poconos.
Poconos.
So it's outside of the Poconos in Pennsylvania. And you would drive by this bar a billion times, but my girlfriend at the time, she sees it. Ooh, let's stop there. Like, all right, fine. And when we get there, you got to walk up this long-ass dirt driveway. And I always remember, it's lined with trees. And this dude in camo pops out. He's not looking at us. He's going to the bar. But he pops out. It was the first day of bow season. So he's head-to-toe camo. And he's got his gear with him. I'm just like, oh, man. And when we open the door to this bar, honest to God, it was pretty much. Except there's no music playing, but I'm still pretty sure I heard that sound. And he goes dead silent, which I hate. So I'm just like, you know what? I'm going to saddle up to the bar anyway. I mean, we're here. I'm not going to make it that obvious that I'm uncomfortable. So I sit down. Everyone's looking at me. Bartender even walks over and makes the joke. Y'all ain't from around here, are you? I was like, what gave it away? So he goes, well, where are you from? Like, I'm from Baltimore. This is when luck smiled on me. It turns out the guys that were drinking in there, they're part of the Bricklayers Union whatever number. And they were the guys that did all the bricks for Oriole Park at Camden Yards, which at that point had only been completed like 2 or 3 years. So they're like, we did some work in Baltimore. Like,
They were there for a few years.
Yeah. And they were like, man, we did your stadium. So I'm like, oh, my God, that's the most beautiful baseball state. They're like, you're damn right.
It is.
They're buying me beers. I mean, by the time we left, dude, it's like, hi, Jim, Jeff, Frank, Gucci. Good to see you guys, man.
Hey, look, on the other side, I know I've told the story, but that one day, I don't know what part of Baltimore we were in. We dropped Miles' car off at the dealership. We're riding together in my old-ass Topaz. We stop at this liquor store. And I was like, is there a bar around here? And the guy's like, yeah, there's one through the back. And same thing. They just looked at us. They, again, not angry. They just seemed shocked that two random white dudes were just walking in. But sports saves us because Miles does one shot. And just like, F the guy in the Steelers ass. And then we were good to go.
But I mean, he looked over at me like, what did you say, white boy? I was like, oh. Steelers. They suck.
I mean, right, it's like kind of like a thrill say, just the opposite. I mean, when we walked in, it just got quiet. And I mean, almost like amazement. Like we were like zoo animals. They were just like, what are these two doing in here?
Because you're either cops or you're crazy. That is the Baltimore way. Two white boys walking to a place with black people. They cops, 5-0.
We went crazy.
What do you mean?
Well,
just at the bar?
I mean, we barely did one shot. Miles started cursing at it, too. So I think they thought, like, oh, they're kind of crazy white guys.
But by the end of it, we're all doing shots together.
That we were.
Hanging out.
Hey, look, his mouth helped us out a ton.
That never happens. Where is the last place on earth that you'd recommend anyone going and why? 206-803-ROCK.
99.9 KISW. The Men's Room returns with Miles and Thrill.
Who sucks less? On the way right after emails on our question, where is the last place on earth that you would recommend anyone going to and why? 206-803-ROCK.
We got a text here. It says, I remember a story from Thrill a long time ago where he stayed at some motel or hotel when he was traveling, and the KKK was also staying there. I can't remember where. It was Mount Pelier, Ohio. On my way to Chicago, Illinois. This was 2 days, believe it or not, before the OJ low-speed chase in the Bronco. Okay. All right, so it's right around then. Anyway, driving to Chicago. It has now hit nighttime. We've been driving for hours. Super, super tired. Need a place to stay. We see a sign that says Mount Pelier, Ohio. I don't know anything about this town, but they got to have a place to stay, right?
Of course.
So we pull in, find a motel, and what's crazy is, as we're driving through, like, every motel had no occupancy.
Right? So it's packed.
We couldn't figure out why, because I'm like, what is it in this part of the country? Because, man, it is desolate. There is nothing going on. So, I mean, 10 miles coming into town, there's nothing. No occupancy. Finally, there's one motel occupancy. Like, cool, we got to pull in. We got to do it. We got to get some sleep, man. So pull in like a typical motel, you know, the office, no lobby, but they have a little office, and walk in, and it's this Indian dude behind the counter. And when I open the door, he just, you know, the face of someone just looks scared, but you don't know why. You know, the eyes look a little shifty and that kind of thing, and he's just kind of stiff. So I walk in, I'm like, oh, hey, man, do you have any rooms left? He's like, I do, but I do not believe you will want to stay here. I'm like, you're not wrong, but I'm about to fall asleep at the wheel, brother. Like, I got to get some sleep. And he's like, listen to me. I have one room left. I said, okay, I'll take it. He said, no, I am not done. All of the other rooms, because a Klan rally is in town. I'm like, are you kidding me? The KKK. He's like, yes, the KKK is in town. They have rented all of my rooms. I'm like, they don't like you either. He's like, yeah, but I run the place. So he's like, I can give you the room. I said, listen, seriously, I'm about to fall asleep standing up. So this is the deal I'll make with you. What is their earliest wake-up call? So he's flipping through his little paper. He's like, I have one for 6 a.m. tomorrow morning. I said, call my room at 5 a.m. Wake me up. I'll be out of here. They won't even know why I was here. He's like, okay. Sure enough, 5 a.m., same guy. He calls me, man, wakes me up. I probably packed that car in 2 minutes. Well, that's the thing about a motel. You know, once you're outside packing up your car, you're just looking at everyone else's windows.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, if anyone opens that window. So the girl I'm with at the time is like, we got a couple, like, Coca-Cola's left, whatever. The ice machine is out in the hall. So I'm not opening this door and going down to the ice machine. Like, look, you can either drink a warm Coke or go the hell to sleep or get a handful of water out of the sink. We are in this room until this guy calls.
Yes.
Because every other room has a guy from the Klan in it.
Where's the last place on earth that you'd recommend anyone going and why? 206-803-ROCK.
Montpelier, Ohio. Hello, David. Welcome to the men's room.
Hola.
Hola.
So mine would have to be Dayton, Ohio.
Yeah.
So about 3 years ago, we lost our business out here and decided to pack up shop and move out that way for a new start.
Why did you pick Dayton in the first place?
Financial. So we kind of looked up an area of the Midwest where, like, you know, the you know, income to debt ratio and all that, and Dayton was kind of it.
Okay.
And, well, unfortunately, I know why. Everything goes there to die.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it's cheap, but
yeah, there's a reason.
Yeah.
Springfield is not much better.
No. And, it's weird because me and my wife being from out here, like, it's real segregated out there, and it's obviously, you know, out here it's a cultural melting pot, and we're not used to that. And we weren't very liked. We didn't feel very liked.
Did you go there and open up your business again or just to relocate and start over?
No, we sure did it. We tried. It's a lot harder to start businesses out there for some reason. It's also really oversaturated. It was a small construction company.
Ah, okay. Well, that makes sense. Yeah.
Right. So we just ended up coming back. And, man, it's good to be home.
How long did you spend there?
3 years.
Ooh. Some of the longest years of your life, I'm guessing.
And why didn't you blend into Dayton, Ohio? What was the stereotype going on there?
Literacy.
Well, I'm a redhead, so I don't really blend anywhere. But we lived out there on the east side, and the east side of Dayton is mainly black, and we're white. So we were in a 10 unit apartment, and we were the only white family in a black neighborhood.
Okay.
So we just off rip. We weren't liked, and I was told so by one of the neighbors.
Well, at least you can appreciate the honesty.
Yeah. I just don't like
it. I don't like you.
I can't expect that.
Mm-hmm. All right, cool, man. Did you say it's because I'm a redhead, isn't it?
Right. I just assumed that, you know.
Also, man, once you get that area of Ohio, if you're not used to the smell of just farm and manure, whenever the wind blows, it smells like cow crap.
Ohio's just not great, man. I mean, it's like I said, there's Cleveland, and Cleveland does okay. People make fun of Cleveland, but it's come a long way. So is its MO. But, man, outside of that, Ohio.
I went to a high school party, and 75% of the people who were at that party in the fall were wearing their FFA, Future Farmers of America, jackets, which were kind of purplish blue corduroy coats with patches and all that stuff. And I'm like, damn, they've got a huge FFA, man.
You're wearing it at that age.
It's the entire, and all those guys and gals, they were all raising their own livestock for competitions and
of course
all those things.
I mean, Ohio's mostly farms. Used to be a lot of car manufacturers.
Absolutely.
A lot of those jobs, they moved them other places and stuff. It's like, yeah, I'm with you. Ohio doesn't do much for me.
Yeah, it really does not.
Where's the last place on earth you'd recommend anyone going and why? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Chris. Welcome to the men's room.
Hola.
Hola.
Hola. Well, guys, I told your screener the entire state of Ohio, but pretty well covered by other callers. So your choice, more Ohio or boring Oregon.
Yeah, as in the city boring Oregon, right?
Say that. I'm sorry?
As in the actual city of boring Oregon?
I'd call it a town over a city, but yeah, boring Oregon. Halfway between Gresham and Sandy as you're going Highway 26 up to Mount Hood.
What makes it so bad? I mean, the name seems to explain a lot.
There is nothing there. I mean, I checked. They've got a new golf course now, and that is still just a remake of what was there 30 years ago when I was growing up there. And it still contains, which is what would be the only thing that appeals to me now, the only bar in town. It's the 19th hole at said golf course.
Really? That's the only bar in town?
That is the only bar in Boring, which is amazing to me. But it was when I was back in the 80s and 90s when I was there, it was very Christian and very conservative country. So kind of makes sense that there's not a whole lot of
bars, strip clubs, etc. Sure.
Oh, right. God, no strip clubs.
Now, let me ask you this, though. So someone comes up to you and they say, look, you got one of two choices. You can move back to boring Oregon or you can move back to Ohio. Which one are you picking?
Boring Oregon, because then I can at least go to Portland and enjoy myself.
There's an escape. Or Bend. I mean, there's two options.
Yeah, Bend's a little farther. Like, Gresham, I've been there a few times. I have some friends down there. But, like, there's not much going on. You're right at the edge. But it is beautiful.
Sure, sure.
Like, it's summertime. You got the river right there and this and that. So, I mean, that is one thing I will take over some of these small towns in Washington and Oregon over, like, Ohio. It's just natural beauty.
I was going to say, man, one of the things that the small towns have on both coasts, really, for the most part, or along the Great Lakes, you get water. It might be a rotten town like Atlantic City, but there is a beach if you need to escape. And Atlantic City is close to actual culture, but New York City, Philly.
Also, Ocean City's not bad. Right, but Cape May's not bad.
When you get to the West Coast, it might be a terrifying place to be. But again, you know what I mean? Just between the trees, the mountains. If you're in Eastern Washington, the desert. Like, when you are in the Midwest, man, you know, Oklahoma, Ohio, it's just ugly. So even the nature that's there is what's left after all the mountains have been strip mined, and it's an awful, hideous place.
Boring also knows what it is. One of my favorite fun facts about it. Do you guys know the sister cities of Boring, Oregon?
Like Snoozeville, Arkansas.
Close. Dull, Scotland, and Bland, dull. Australia.
Okay. It all makes sense.
Dull. Damn. I feel like that's worse than boring.
Where is the last place on earth you would recommend anyone going, and why? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Doc. Welcome to the men's room.
What's up, buttercups?
Hola.
Hey, mine is, I got two towns in Somalia. When I was there in the military back in 93, it was Mogadishu.
That's the one I can name. Yep.
And Kismayu. Kismayu was all desert. The whole country is nothing but desert anyway, even though Mogadishu is right on the Indian Ocean. But Kismayu was like Georgia, but a desert. It was red dust.
How long were you stuck there?
4 months.
Were you part of were you in the Rangers?
Black Hawk Down?
Yeah.
No. Oh. I was medical support for the military.
Okay.
And we were there at right after the Rangers took the beach or whatever, you know, and then right before that event that happened that they did Black Hawk Down about.
Now, that not you, sir, but the rest of us in the studio, did we all learn Mogadishu from Geraldo Rivera?
No, I know it from Black Hawk Down and the Mogadishu Mile.
I just remember Geraldo Rivera. When all this was going down, right before you probably got there, Doc, I just remember Geraldo Rivera, they'd always pitch to him because he was physically there. But it's just the way he said it, and everyone would make fun of the way he said, I'm in Mogadishu. I don't know why, but for some reason, that's the only way he seemed to pronounce it. That's the first time I'd heard of it.
I guess it adds up what you did in the military now, Doc.
Doc.
Well, that's been my nickname from knee-high to a grasshopper, but I'll take it. And plus, you can refer to a cartoon character or one of the seven dwarves that don't end in Y.
Okay.
By the way, where are you from originally?
From a little town called Morehead City, North Carolina, almost at the start of the Outer Banks.
Okay. I was just saying, when you hear the quote, knee-high to a grasshopper, I'm like, okay.
I got to tell you, Doc, that is one of the most remote areas on the East Coast as far as the accessibility to get there. You know, the East Coast, you can get anywhere fairly quickly with a highway system. It's not too crazy, even in the Northeast with the traffic and everything else. That two-lane road, man, to the Outer Banks from Norfolk all the way down, or if you're coming up the other side, that is the most traffic... unexplained. It takes forever. Even if you're in Raleigh, you can't get over there.
Right.
I mean, that's what I was going to say.
You're right. That's where I fly into from out here. And man, it takes about 2.5 hours to get to my hometown. And we're not quite, we're like, you know, right there by Cape Hatteras. We're not too far from there. And it's quite the haul. I can tell you that. But
Well, all those houses up on Duck and Corral are basically just falling into the Atlantic Ocean where they put everything out on those sand dunes, man. They're just, talking like 10-bedroom homes.
Our sand dunes are gone from the hurricanes, but we're on that little piece of land that runs east and west, you know, before the Outer Banks start as it goes up. And so I actually get to watch the sun rise and set.
That's pretty nice.
That's pretty cool.
And to go through the brew-through, which is always nice.
Yes, the brew-through.
I mean, the Outer Banks is great, but you're right. Like, I've been there a few times, and it's funny. It's like, what, 7-8 hours to get? But the problem is, you get to the Outer Banks pretty quickly, but Miles is right. Imagine thousands of people flooding a town, these little small towns, and it's literally one way or one lane each way.
I'll tell you what, one of the coolest experiences as a young drinker was a place called the Beer Barn, which was in Florida. And the Beer Barn, it's a barn, but a modern barn. So it's not like an old barn. It's just shaped like a barn. Right. But you drive through...
Well, it's a beer barn.
Yeah, you drive through the...
Like beer caves aren't real caves.
You drive through the middle of the barn. So it's got an open front door and an open back door.
Yeah.
You drive through the middle of it. To your right is chips, snacks, a wall of, you know, of coolers, of beer. And
do you grab it yourself or do people hand it to you through the window?
No, they walk up to the window and they say, what would you like? They hand you a sheet of paper or there's signs, but you can basically see everything.
Like, all right.
Give me a couple bags of chips. Give me a Snickers bar, 2 12 packs of, you know, Miller High Life.
And that's cool. I like that idea,
then
man.
Then you drive out. And I was like, this is going to take the world by storm. Every town needs one of these. This is amazing.
You're not wrong. Every town does need one of those.
Also, they had a slushy machine, and they were making drinks to go.
I know. That stuff's ridiculous.
You could get a pina colada and a plastic
cup. They don't care. Florida, man.
Oh, yeah.
It does not matter.
Whereas the last place on earth you would recommend anyone going and why? 206-803-ROCK.
Speaking of Florida and how little they care about drinking, and I've said this before, but stopped at the gas station to get a pack of smokes. And at this point, it's nighttime, so you can only go up to the outside window. And there's a guy, like two people in front of me, man, and he cannot stand up straight. He is just absolutely smashed. Goes up to the window, mumbles something to the cashier. She finally figures out what the hell he's saying. He's getting another six-pack of beer. No big deal. She hands it to him. He pays. He is stumbling, ricocheting off the gas pumps. And then he climbs into a Pontiac Fiero with one working headlight. Now, keep in mind, he's not getting in on the passenger side. He gets in on the driver's side. And he starts to scar. My wife's sitting in the car, and I'm looking at her like, are you seeing this? And she's like, you've got to be kidding me. Starts his car, and it reverses out of the gas station. And this is, it's called Military Highway. This is a made with Delray Beach, Florida. This is a major, major artery in this part of the country. He drove in reverse until we could not see him anymore. Like, he just went into the flow of traffic. So you see everyone else's taillights, and there's one single headlight looking back at you getting smaller. He drove in reverse hammered. I've never, and I just watched him go all the way down the road, and I'm like, oh, my God. And nobody even batted an eye, man.
Where's the last place on earth that you'd recommend anyone going and why? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Mike. Welcome to the men's room.
Gents, how's it going?
Hola.
All right. So this was when I was in the Navy. And so I flew into this little place called Wake Island, and it is a postage stamp in the middle of the Pacific. It is no joke. 5 hours west, like a 5-hour flight west of Hawaii, 5 hours east of Japan. I mean, it is middle of nowhere. So
is that like French Polynesia?
Man, I don't know my geography down there very well, but
Guam?
I mean, just think
is that near Guam?
It's smaller than Guam. I mean, it's about 4 hours from Guam. Three. But it's one of those like old World War II, like it's maybe a couple miles by a couple miles kind of thing, and next. You know, island is forever. So we get in there, we land, and the person we've been talking to, because we're going to be doing a site visit, was like, hey, our supply flight got canceled for this week. So can you kind of bring some stuff in for us? Like, so he gave us a list of like logs of dip, cigarettes, everything like this. So we get there. The first thing we do when we get off the plane is like, hey, man, you got the stuff. So I hand him this plastic bag full of like tobacco. He's like, all right, cool, great. You're welcome. Super friendly. He's like, why don't you guys go ahead and grab lunch real quick before the cafeteria closes? All right, cool. So get down there. They have those bowls.
Uh-oh.
And Mike, your phone's breaking up, man.
Hey, Mike?
Mike's gone.
He's gone. Damn it, man.
Yeah.
Hello, Kenny. Welcome to the men's room.
What's up, fellas?
Hola.
Hola. So, my story's about Branson, Missouri. Any of you guys ever been there?
Haven't been, no? But we've heard about it. You know, what are they called? The mini whatever.
We know the legend that is Branson.
Yeah. So, I was estranged from my natural father for like 30 plus years. He came out to visit us one year, like 30 years ago. And the next year, he's like, you guys need to come out to Omaha and stay for a week. And we've got a family reunion in Branson. I'm like, okay, cool. So we went out, stayed there, drove the freaking 5 hours or whatever from Omaha to get to Branson. Once you get to Branson, it's like Little Reno. It's like, but the funny part of this whole story is he booked us in the Lawrence Welk Hotel.
Oh my God.
Oh, tiny bubbles.
He was so proud that he booked us in this hotel. And this hotel, I don't think, had been updated since Lawrence Welk was on
Carson. I would say, what would you expect, though, once you say Lawrence Welk? Like, oh boy. This is going to be the uncoolest place.
Bubbles flying everywhere. But getting into Branson, it was like one lane each way. And it's like all these country, you know, I think Willie Nelson and Dolly Parton were playing at some of the casinos or something. So it was like bumper to bumper. It took us 5 hours to get to Branson. It took us another 2 hours to get through Branson to get to the hotel. It was hell.
And then in the end, you're in Branson for all that trouble. Yeah.
Yeah.
How many rooms do you think the Lawrence Welk Hotel had?
It was a pretty big place, but it was like turquoise carpeting. Yeah. And I mean, just like,
man, there's a lot of places in Tennessee. There's a lot of places in Kentucky, West Virginia that still have that old colonial type decor with flowered drapes and just gaudy furniture.
I think it's that whole part of the country. Because again, I think Ohio, central PA, like if you really want to feel like Betty Crocker is still alive and cooking for you in the kitchen, stay in one of these places.
Poconos. It's always
God, like Poconos are the worst.
It's, man, oh, man. Who Sucks Less is coming up, and we've got your emails on the way from the men's room at KISW.com next.
For those in the market for flavor, there's Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, a flavorful drink that's a modern twist on a Mexican street classic with four vibrant and refreshing flavors. Pineapple, watermelon, hibiscus, and cucumber lime, made with a splash of real fruit juice. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas are perfect for any fiesta, small or big. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas. Boldly authentic, vibrantly flavorful. Drink responsibly. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas flavored beers imported by Crown Imports, Chicago, Illinois. Hibiscus contains juice only for color.
At Metro, get an iPhone 12 with 5G and a dual camera system for $99.99. Take amazing pictures and share them instantly. And don't put up with life's yada yada.
Yada yada.
Like photo bombers. Zoom, crop out,
yada yada,
and bye.
You don't take yada yada in life, don't take yada yada from your wireless provider. Get iPhone 12 with 5G with no activation fees and nada yada yada. Only at Metro by T-Mobile. Switch to Metro, bring your ID. This offer isn't available for customers currently at T-Mobile or that have been with Metro in the past 180 days.
Without the ones like you who work tirelessly to keep things running, everything would suddenly stop. Hospitals, factories, schools, and power plants, they all depend on you. No matter the weather, emergency, or time of day, you're the ones who get it done. At Grainger, we're here for you with professional-grade industrial supplies. Count on real-time product availability and fast delivery. Call, clickgrainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
Hey, Whatcom County. The holidays are over and lots of Americans are financially drained. Luckily, Bayside Coin and Jewelry pays top dollar for scrap gold, jewelry, and gold, silver, or platinum coins. If you have a pile of old jewelry or a stash of silver dollars, bring them into the store and see what they're worth. Or visit PacificRimCoins.com/calculator to get an instant quote using our free scrap calculator. That's PacificRimCoins.com/calculator for an instant quote.
What's up? It's your boy, The Ted Smith from The Men's Room. And did you know I have a podcast? Well, I do. The Podcast. New episodes uploaded every Wednesday on the Odyssey app.
The debauchery rolls on. You're listening to The Men's Room with Miles and Thrill. 99.9 KISW.
KISW.
Who Sucks Less is on the way, but first a few emails from the men's room at KISW.com.
You've got mail.
And a couple from our question, where is the last place on earth that you'd recommend anyone going and why? Guys, Ola, I have it on good authority that what is best to avoid? Gorda, California. Small town that is amidst the Big Sur mountain range off the California coast, just off the Pacific Coast Highway, north of San Luis. I can best describe it as like Letterkenny, but it's slower. Not something I enjoy watching, and it sort of reminds me of an episode of the original Twilight Zone, but off. For my money, just go further north to Monterey instead. Liquor and whores, guys. That from Dennis. I have made the drive between Seattle and Denver several times, and the place that sucks the most is Utah. The way the Mormons look at you makes you feel like a piece of garbage. The second worst is Shelton, Washington.
Wow.
That from Big Pun in Kennewick.
Shelton, huh?
Shelton. As we move on to the birthdays. Oh, look, can I get a May Day happy 21st birthday to my son, Jake? Can he get a bong rip? And can Coach Ted give him a pep talk on how he's fully legal? LOL. Thank you so much. That from longtime listener Danielle.
All right, 21. First of all, you're going with 21 run this weekend. Coach could give you advice about water and bananas. That's not going to happen. Your friend's going to buy you a bunch of shots. You're probably going to puke your brains out. Let's move on past this weekend. When you travel, go to nightclubs, all right? Go see DJs. Just do stuff that you can do in your 20s, maybe early 30s. But Coach Ted likes to go see a DJ, but I'm the old guy. I got to pay extra to sit in VIP. It's the truth.
Really?
When's the last time you've been to a nightclub?
Oh, God.
That explains it.
Yeah.
Right. If you go to a nightclub, I just feel like once you're past 40, it's like you got to spend the extra money to get a table.
Okay. All naked ladies.
Seriously, dude.
Sending a birthday request for my bro, Peter. He is beginning his 54th trip around the big ball of fire that we sometimes see here in Seattle. So could he get an original fish sandwich? And oh, my God, what the hell is that, bro? A bong rip, too. Happy birthday, Pete. A big aloha from Mason.
Two Oregon fish sandwich.
Oh my God, what the f*** is that, bro?
Hi guys, here you go.
Happy birthday to you.
Yaws of Dirty Germans, brought to you by Men's Room Original Sausage. Available through Uli's World Famous Sausage, mensroomlive.com, and other fine retailers. Mmm, Schweineflash.
Thank you, Bob. A couple extra emails here. Old Bacholos, I finally got to visit Uli, support the Fisher House, and grub hard on some killer brats. The Men's Room beer brought. Once again, epic work. Just said the six-pack of IPA didn't last long enough to go with them. Thanks for all you do. We need more laughter in this world, and you guys always deliver. That from Scott, who made a delicious meal there with the Men's Room beer brought. Couple more. Men's Room IPA locations keep coming in. Thank you for sending those to the Men's Room at KISW.com, along with the photos of the displays you find. The Albertsons in Port Orchard has Men's Room IPA. That from Ryan in Port Orchard. Fellows, longtime listener, just want to let you know that I carry the Men's Room IPA on tap in my bar. The pub is at Piper's Creek. The pub at Piper's Creek in Greenwood. Come on by sometime and let me buy you a pint and a shot of fine tequila.
All right.
Thank you. That from your local bartender, Bobby. I have been in that bar before. That bar's got about maybe four or more pool tables.
Oh, really? Okay.
Old school hamburgers. Chicken wings. It's a good bar.
I know exactly where it is, but I don't know that I've been in there.
It's called Piper's Pub?
Piper's Pub. It's kind of up by the rickshaw, 105th and...
yeah, it's a little bit up there.
105th, yeah, 105th and Greenwood-ish.
Mm-hmm. Ola Dinosaurs, the Men's Room IPA is now on tap at Birch and Barley in Pullman, Washington.
Yeah!
Shout out to our kick-ass bar manager, Hannah, for bringing it on. Go Cougs and go Vandals. All the best, gents. That from Josh, the Doctor.
Hannah, I hope you can find people in Pullman to drink.
That would be tough. Enjoying the Men's Room IPA while camping in Glacier.
Finally got it at the Safeway in Oak Harbor. Thanks, guys. That from Brett and a couple more. Subject, what have you done that you're proud of? Gentlemen, someone from my hometown passed away in a accident, in a truck accident west of Cleelm a few years back. Shut down I-90 for quite some time. He left behind his wife and daughters. I was a personal trainer at the time and decided to do a charity row for him. I rode for an hour continuously, and people donated money for every meter that I rode. People donated money for every meter that I rode, ending up raising $5,000 for his family.
All right.
I prefer to keep this anonymous, as I never told anyone that I was doing it, but I'm proud of doing it.
Good, man.
Guys, a couple things I'm proud of or at. Weirdly, I'm good at selling companies. I co-owned a dial-up ISP in the 90s and did fairly well when selling it. Also owned a piece of large distribution company with family members, and I led selling this company as well. That sale worked out extremely well. Being said financially, I've donated and given away about $500,000 in the last 6 years. I do it anonymously, but proud of that. I've also donated blood about 50 times and volunteered at the Puget Sound Blood Center. I've donated platelets about 10 times, which is a three-hour process.
Wow, I didn't realize it took that long.
Cheers, guys. And from Jim, your loyal Pasco podcaster. And one more on being proud. Guys, catching up on the podcast on the Odyssey app, want to share something I'm proud of. Never a big tech junkie, and I don't really use social media. But 3 years ago, I stumbled across a video on YouTube about learning how to code and make apps.
Okay.
I was immediately hooked. So after 3 grueling years of waking up 3 hours earlier than normal before work to study and teach myself what I needed to know, I'm proud to say my first app should be out in about 3 weeks.
Damn.
The Google Play Store requires 20 people to test it for 14 days before a full release can happen. And it's currently in that process. Maybe it'll help me land one of those six-figure jobs in the near future. Thanks, guys. That from Brett.
Now, the men's room wants to know, who sucks less?
Hey, time for Who Sucks Less. Steve and Thrill Hill, you bring us 3 stories from the news each and every week. They always suck, but up to us to determine, out of the 3 stories, which one sucks the least. Now, if you happen to follow KISW on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, the debate is already underway on Who Sucks Less.
Yes, indeed. And like I said at the top of the show, if you weren't with us, you know, the stories always suck. Some people do things that are worse than others. These people have not done the worst things, and yet somehow you're going to want to beat the living piss out of each and every one of them. Let's start in Oregon, where a man broke into the Winchester Bay Salmon Trout Enhancement Program and poured bleach into a Chinook salmon tank, killing 18,000 fish. Now, authorities arrested 20-year-old Joshua Alexander Heckathorn. He's a resident of Garden, Oregon. They arrested him a day after the chemicals were dumped into one of the hatchery ponds. So he told the cops, well, he had visited a storage area the day before and then picked up a bottle of bleach. That's the entire explanation. Anyway, he was arrested and booked into the Douglas County Jail on Tuesday for second-degree burglary, criminal trespass, and criminal mischief. Now, the maximum penalty for poaching Chinook salmon, it's a species that is protected under the Endangered Species Act, is $750.
Per fish?
Per fish. So, officials assess the fines for every salmon killed. He could be asked to pay nearly $14 million. Now, volunteers, they drained the pond and they removed the dead fish, again, 18,000 of them, which were then frozen and taken to the Oregon State Police as evidence, because I'm sure the judge would be like, I need to see all 18,000 of these dead fish. The young fish, returning from the ocean as adults in 3 to 4 years, they would have added 200 to 400 fully grown salmon available for harvest for the fishers, generating much needed revenue for the local economies. Anyway, the 3 to 4 inch long salmon smolt, they were supposed to be released in 2 months, actually next month in June, into the lower Umpqua River, and they would eventually make their way to Alaska. Now, Chinook salmon, as you might know, it's Oregon state fish, but they hatch in freshwater streams, grow there for a year before making the journey to the ocean. Then they spend between 1 and 5 years in the ocean before using their sense of smell to return to the home rivers to spawn and die. And they're the largest of Pacific salmon and typically grow up to 25 pounds. Some have clocked in at 100 pounds. So why he did this, no one seems to know other than him just being a douche.
Bam. Wow. Back to Coos Bay. That's the river that kind of flows.
So they have, I can't remember how many hatcheries they said that they have along the coast there, but yeah, this guy visited the hatchery, bought bleach, came back the next day and killed 18,000 salmon for no particular reason. And now we have more water stuff. We go to the other side of the country, Florida, where a group of boozed up spring breakers Well, they have infuriated locals in Florida after dumping two huge trash cans full of, well, trash directly into the ocean. The partygoers are likely some of the 10,000 revelers attending the annual Boca Bash over the weekend, but in video footage that was shared online, the group can be seen emptying the trash from their boat into the open water. They took the time to put the trash into the trash can, then they're zipping along, just took the trash cans and dumped them into the ocean while cheering and woo-hooing and all the stuff the dumbasses do. One of the locals said, quote, "It really just infuriates you to see someone trash the ocean like that. You know, nobody else on the boat even tried to stop them. Everyone was celebrating. I mean, they already had trash sitting in the garbage can. They could have just put it in a bag or grabbed a bag, filled it up, and thrown it away. Instead, they just dump it carelessly into the ocean. It's just really sad to see." Anyway, Boca Bash representatives told the outlet that the Spring Breakers, they have been ID'd, calling their behavior completely unacceptable. The local police and Florida Fish and Wildlife Conservation Commission, they have launched an investigation into littering. That's it. That's all they will get for that. Too. And I saw the video, man. It actually just pisses you off.
Yes,
like, what is the point of this, man? Come on.
They were going into pretty rough water, too, to do that.
They were, but they're still reasonably close to the shore. Whatever, man. I don't understand it.
Honestly, I've read a few things about it. They were pretty sure the story I read, they're on their parents' boat. They're underage.
Yeah.
So I think part of that was,
we don't want to go evidence.
To the, right, don't want to go to the dock with cans of beer.
Jesus Christ.
Not an excuse, just saying.
No, I get what you're saying. And now let's stay in Florida. This is not individuals. This is the old world of insurance. And we know insurance is a giant scam, right? You are federally mandated to have it, and then when you actually need it, they do what they can to not pay out, which is such a ridiculous setup. Anyway, in this case, Progressive. That's right, Flo. We're talking to you, bitch. With just weeks before the start of hurricane season, thousands of homeowners in Southwest Florida, you know, they're being dropped by their home insurance companies. Because you might not believe in climate change, but guess what? Insurance companies do. So the letters from Progressives, they started going out this week. The company reported last year did plan to shed about 100,000 policies. But Jeff Kunif of Bonita Springs said he received one of the letters and immediately began looking for a replacement coverage. But he said the problem is they're just reducing the hurricane insurance and a lot of people on the same boat. But in many cases, people are just being forced to pay a lot more for the coverage that they are already paying for. But Progressive recognizes that that land's eroding and sinking, so they don't want to pay it. They'll take your money, but they ain't trying to help you out. He says, I think it's a big problem for a lot of people. Well, you don't say. Now, the letters are catching many people by surprise. Although Progressive did announce a year ago that they were cutting back in Florida because of the risk, they just didn't say what areas of Florida. Because you could be anywhere in Florida, right? And you have that same potential risk. Well, an agent with a different insurer says he has hundreds of clients that are impacted by the move. And he says his company's going to try to step up with a lot of the policyholders so they don't go into sticker shock. But he makes no guarantees. He just said, hey, we understand this, and we've pledged to make every possible attempt to reduce or remove that sticker shock, at least for the initial stages of this transition. However, many policyholders still have to find another company, and it might not be so easy for a lot of people because they have 34 days until the start of hurricane season, and if you don't already have this money set aside to pay these premiums, they're screwed. That's basically that's insurance being insurance, but it's still
typically
pisses
me off. That part of Florida wasn't the most hit. It was avoided for about 30 years.
It was,
and then all of a sudden, probably 3 or 4 years ago, everything changed and it really started hitting the west coast of Florida more and more.
Yes, it did. So
yeah, before it would blow straight up into New Orleans, it would miss the elbow, so to speak.
And Progressive would still cover you then.
Yeah.
Now that they understand that the weather patterns have changed, they're like, we're not paying out this money.
Panama City used to be the place that would get hit all the way west to New Orleans. Now that is going east.
Yep.
So
again, we have the guy in Oregon who inexplicably dumped bleach into a salmon tank, killed 18,000 fish, which does work for the local economy, etc. Ted, don't ever cough again. We have the Florida kids, the Spring Breakers. Maybe they're underage. I don't know. Either way, they took two full trash cans full of trash and just dumped it into the ocean. And God, man, seriously, just that part of the country, when you see the ocean, it is crystal clear water. In fact, you could see their trash easily. And then finally, we have specifically in this case, Progressive, just dumping all the hurricane insurance for people that live in a hurricane zone about a month before hurricane season starts because they don't feel like spending the money you've given them.
Okay. I don't agree with what Progressive did at all. And I don't think anybody who is, you know, has any type of insurance would agree
you
with
you. Tell me that I must have insurance. I feel like the insurance should absolutely have to pay out. If you're telling me that legally I have to have this for my home, and I do have home insurance, that whatever the F goes down, You can send out your goddamn adjuster, but then they legally should be responsible to take the money you've given them to help you.
Florida is the Sunshine State. It is a place that more people are moving to than any other place.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
In my mind, including the Florida Spring Breakers, who put on that kind of behavior, and all the people who go down there and just act. If you've been to Florida, I have my father and my uncle who live there. They're my close relatives, yeah. Right? Obviously. They know what they're getting into.
Sure.
They are not fans of the government. They are not fans of a number of things down there that are just getting a little bit too in your pocket, in your face, and everything else.
Yeah.
But if you live in Florida and you, they vote for that.
Yeah, they do.
I mean, this is right. This is what, look, man, if you ask, you might receive. So
Fair enough.
I'm going to say in this instance, if you are moving to Florida, you better know damn well that there's going to be some weird ass going down on a lot of different levels, just in general, whether that's where your kids go to school, whether that's the roadways, the laws, the governor, the senators, right. All those people that make decisions, you know where you're going. I'm going to say progressive sucks the least.
Flo, thank you.
All right. I'm going to take those kids that dump the trash in the water. It is horrible. They shouldn't have done it. That video has been circulating. It makes it even dumber. It's obviously, it's a drone or a helicopter following.
And they're cheering. You know?
They are. But that Boca Bash is ridiculous. They're not, like, they got that boat from their parents. I'm going, not cutting them slack. I'm just assuming they're like 18, 19, and thought that was the best idea instead of getting a ticket when they parked the boat.
I get completely what you're saying. Yeah.
All right. Debate continues on Who Sucks Less if you follow KISW on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Shout of the Day is coming up. You're listening to The Men's Room.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance too with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance, and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
Without the ones like you, who work tirelessly to keep things running, everything would suddenly stop. Hospitals, factories, schools, and power plants, they all depend on you. No matter the weather, emergency, or time of day, you're the ones who get it done. At Grainger, we're here for you with professional-grade industrial supplies. Count on real-time product availability and fast delivery. Call, clickgrainger.com or just stop by. Grainger. For the ones who get it done.
For those in the market for flavor, there's Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, a flavorful drink that's a modern twist on a Mexican street classic with four vibrant and refreshing flavors. Pineapple, watermelon, hibiscus, and cucumber lime, made with a splash of real fruit juice. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas are perfect for any fiesta, small or big. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, boldly authentic, vibrantly flavorful. Drink responsibly. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas flavored beers imported by Crown Imports, Chicago, Illinois. Hibiscus contains juice only for color.
99.9 KISW. The shenanigans continue. This is the Men's Room with Miles and Thrill.
All right, count up. We'll drink and tell us with a shot of the day. And we do have your headlines on the way at 5:50. But first, quick check out with Mike Hawk and some of the stories and headlines he is not working on.
Thank you, Miles. A supercomputer has predicted that the human race will face a quote-unquote triple whammy extinction event.
Did you read through the whole thing?
I read a little bit of it.
They're saying in about 250 million years.
Correct.
So believe it or not.
Come on.
Right. So that's the clickbait. And you go on. You think it's been nuclear war, right? All the crap going on now. Sure. And they're like, oh, no. Just believe it or not, you'll be closer to the sun. A lot of places get unlivable, but the same scenario you always hear.
Exactly.
None of us will be alive to worry about it, according to the supercomputer.
I was about to say, like, wouldn't we be extinct in 250 million years, just naturally speaking?
I think there's a very good chance of that being the case.
Right. I feel like,
wow, yeah.
Yeah. I feel like we're just going to take ourselves off the board at some point.
Am I wrong in thinking, like, we could go out like the dinosaurs in any given moment, right?
Yeah, I mean, sure, absolutely. Yeah. That's the thing. Yeah. That's assuming everything goes well. So the supercomputer just said, look, if nothing else goes wrong, right, you don't get the dinosaur treatment, you don't annihilate yourselves because you're stupid.
You survived for 250 million years.
Right, so you got like 250 million years. I'm like, well, you didn't tell us anything, dog.
Hey.
I call computers dog. It warms them up to me.
All of them or just the super ones?
Just the super ones, bro.
Yeah, so judgy.
I am. The other ones, I'm like, hey, dumbass.
That's what we hear in, in these offices all the doggone time.
He does, yeah.
Dumbass! Like I said, man, it's... the computer's here. Yeah.
I'm doing 150 years, you might be extinct. All right, Doc.
Oh, thanks.
I see what you're picking up what you're laying down.
Thank you, brother.
I know. Like, honestly, I just don't care.
Sorry for... I don't know how many great generations that is from now. Like, whatever happens to you guys 250 years from now, I don't care.
Right. I can say that, you know, say, man, wait, you know, wait, the planet you want to leave to your kids, absolutely. Grandkids, sure. Absolutely. Great-grandkids, 250 million years from now, like, F them.
Right.
Yeah.
Ain't nobody looking up this genealogy in 250 million years.
You think they still have Ancestry.com, and how thick would that be? We've traced back 250 million freaking years of your lineage.
It probably wouldn't be a .com in 250 million years, Airbud.
Well, what do you think it'd be?
There's going to be some new technology. Like, dude, go back 100 years. Yeah, they didn't even know what a .com was.
I know, but this is me. I'd still believe it. Dude, you still have a dial-up? Right. I do.
Still on MySpace, too.
Is that a flip phone? Sure is.
Darn right. Sure it's the Nokia. Bulletproof.
They use lasers now.
That's right. A woman revealed online that she lives with a cardboard cutout of her husband... because he's been in jail since they've met.
I didn't read through the whole story, so I mean, like, part of it goes like...
They met through a pen pal program.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, never mind. I'm done.
She deleted her social media because she was getting bullied online because she really hadn't ever...
I mean, you don't have to bully the woman. Just think what we're all thinking and not tell her.
Exactly.
You know what I mean?
Bully her in your mind.
It's like when someone's super duper double down ugly... And you know
double
that
down ugly.
It's what I call it factually ugly. Like there is no one that has an opinion that you're a good looking person.
You're not doing anything to fix it. You're doubling down on your ugly.
But we don't say, God damn, you're ugly. You know, you just don't do it.
You do, but you're behind the glass.
But you know, but everyone's thinking it. But we're not going to take. We're not cruel. We're just observing that. Right. Jesus H. Christ.
And that's the problem with social media is that of course everybody had these thoughts, but you weren't putting them in the comment section. Don't,
right. Look, you're the Gary Indiana of human looks. Right. Just it's
right.
Bad.
And it goes the opposite way too. Right. Like first thing I told you on Sunday,
I said this waitress, at the doghouse, was just ungodly hot.
Yes.
Like I couldn't. Like I got. Barely spoke twice, but like I wouldn't be like Jesus Christ, you're the hottest woman I've ever seen in my life.
Right,
right.
Like my God.
Right. So you don't.
She knows.
I can't even order a beer. You're so hot.
God Almighty. Was she that good looking?
Yes.
Wow. Okay.
Also, just kind of like sporty dressed. I just
She checked all of your boxes.
Man was in love.
Jesus Christ. I'm telling you, it was like the first thing I said to Mike when I picked him up in the Uber.
Can I live here?
Yeah, and she was a great waitress and everything, but just, she asked me one question and I was just like, I don't know, beer. Like, can I just order from the bar?
Hod's great personality and brings you beer like a pro.
Yeah. I wonder how she got that job.
Check, check, check. Someone stole the Smokey Bear sign from Flathead National Park.
Only you can steal me.
Another Flathead from Flathead.
Where is that?
Montana?
Oh, that makes sense. All right. I'm like, Flathead Lake. Yeah, come on, Ted.
Yeah.
I'm still thinking about that chick. Sorry.
It's a good looking chick.
Like, I know stuff about Flathead.
You want to go there? There's a smoking the bear sign missing.
That's why you want to go.
We can go to Martha's too.
Right.
They're not near as hot as you.
Oh my God. Oh my God, oh my God.
The sun is not as hot as you, ma'am.
The best one was in Scottsdale, right? And keep in mind, if you've ever been to Scottsdale, you know this, right? Look, me and my buddies and my brother, we're Diamond Dozen, right? Group of guys, like 30s or 40s, either playing golf or watching spring training.
Yeah.
Right. But Scottsdale is a good job. Scottsdale, also you have ASU right there. There's a large amount of very attractive women.
Yes, there is.
But also there's so many of them.
I've been there.
Yeah, it's also just friendlier, right? There's they're chatting with you, blah blah blah. So it's during the day on Sunday, we're at somebody's bar. I forget one of the musicians or whatever, and the bartender is talking to us the whole time, but she's wearing like a black zip up hoodie, and then as she walks towards us, it was like a music video. She's just taking it off, but just like. Unzips
it's
it.
All in slow motion.
Right. And like as she takes it off, it's like she's just wearing like a sports bra or something. And my buddy's usually pretty cool with women. And I mean, he just couldn't get a word out.
Oh, I think what? Oh my God.
Oh my God. Everything okay, gentlemen? Actually, everything's great.
Everything's fine as
Lord Jesus.
I'm telling you, it's like a music video.
Fine,
right?
Can you do that again?
Right, and it was like 12:15. It's us and one other. There was a couple next to us, one other couple. And the girl's like, she goes, you guys want to do the shot skis? Like, to load it, whatever you want us to pay for.
I will do whatever you ask me to do. I will murder.
Damn, you Dierks Bentley hiring hot staff.
Well, you know, Ted used a handful of phrases there, but we don't always know where the origin of the origins of those phrases come from. So it's time to learn, kids.
The Men's Room Top 10. The Men's Room Top 10. 10
common phrases with hidden meanings you may not know. Like, don't beat around the bush. It commonly means to stop wasting time and get to the point, but historically was associated with hunting. In medieval times, hunters hired men to beat the areas around bushes with sticks to flush out game. They wouldn't hit the bush directly because they might whack a bee's nest.
Yeah.
So don't beat around the bush because you might not like the outcome, you dullard.
Thank you, VD. Common phrases with hidden meanings that you may not know. I had to take a few off this list because, quite frankly, there's a lot of very offensive phrases that we have around here.
However, thank you, Mike. Offensive to me?
Yeah. Why, yes.
Yeah, generally that's how that works.
And others. Yeah. And others. Being moronic shows up on the list. Psychologist Henry H. Goddard is known as one of the pioneers of eugenics, a science rooted... He claimed that he could create a more desirable human population by weeding out the traits that made someone unworthy of reproduction in the eyes of eugenics.
Unworthy of reproduction.
Yeah.
Damn, that's like an insult you want to drop on someone.
He's responsible for coining the term moron, which he indicated as a feeble-minded person, an argument that gained him and his team access to the immigrants attempting to enter America through Ellis Island.
Wow.
Through his work, nearly 40% of immigrants of Jewish, Italian, or Hungarian descent were deported or denied access to the U.S. by way of their moronic classification.
Then black people showed up, and they're like, no, you guys stay.
Right. Hang out here, guys.
Come on, man.
Damn. Do you guys ever figure out where the origin of the deadline came from?
Deadline. Think I know. Is this like a trench warfare thing?
Civil warfare. During the Civil War, the bloody battles fought across stolen land, the Confederate soldiers would hold Union soldiers hostage, a typical war tactic. The Confederates erected crude fences around the small, cramped area where they held the northern POWs. The quote-unquote deadline referred to the promise of immediate death to anyone who attempted to escape by crossing it. Don't miss the deadline.
Sounds like an old neighbor of mine.
I forget the jail they had. It was awful.
Yeah.
What they did to those Union soldiers.
Spaz. Anybody know where the term spaz comes from?
Wasn't it a legitimate, like a physical reaction to something or something?
The word began as a derogatory term to describe someone clumsy, awkward, unaware of their body, or hyperactive. It was offensive because it originally came from the medical term spasticity, a condition that may affect a person's speech patterns and can cause uncontrollable muscle spasms, and it was shortened to spastic and shorten further to spaz. Fun! These are some common phrases with hidden meanings that you may not know. The term bugger.
Bugger.
If you happen to see, well, nearly any British movie in the last 20 years, you more than likely have heard the phrase bugger off uttered. Today, bugger means a mischievous person or a snarky way to tell someone to get away from you. The historical development of the phrase comes from something a little less impish, though. The term is thought to have come from the old French word, the 14th century booger. A word referred to either a heretic or sodomite, depending on the context. Hmm. Yes.
I'm okay with either of those, dude. You're a heretic and a sodomite, hey, brother.
The term hysterical.
That's a woman thing.
Yes, it is.
So hysterical.
Well, think of a hysterectomy.
Correct.
Hysterical. Oh, these bitches are crazy.
The term coined in 1801 in medical Latin
saying it.
To describe a neurotic state believed to be associated with a dysfunctional uterus. The entire premise of the phrase is connected to the inability to control your emotions because you're a woman. Okay. That's where that comes from. That is where that comes from.
Yeah, that is literally why you have hysterical.
Right. Your wife is hysterical. Therefore, it is her nethers that is just making her nuts.
Zappaginis is got. Mm-hmm. That's why that woman crazy.
Her lady parts made her crazy.
Yeah.
Don't worry, it makes us crazy too.
Anybody know painting the town red?
Oh God, I don't. Mike, I don't know if I want to know after the last one.
It's okay. This one isn't nearly as bad.
Oh, Jesus.
Like,
is this a theme?
A nobleman from the small town of Melton, Mowbray, and he was known as a rabble rouser in his day, known as the Mad Marquess to the public. He was well known for fighting, breaking windows, stealing, despite in no way needing to financially, and being politely but firmly asked to leave Oxford University. Legend has it that on one particular night, he and a group of his friends went out and had a destructive night that ended in them finding cans of red paint and literally painting the town red.
Oh, okay.
Oh, so they were having fun.
Yeah, this guy was just a party animal. So that's why it is still associated with, like, we're going to go paint the town red. We're going to get so destroyed that we are literally going to grab cans of paint and paint the town red.
All right. You know what? I'm going to bring that one back. Start using it.
Yeah. Cat got your tongue.
Oh, yep.
Yeah, that is it's a shipping term that was the origin traces back to the English Navy, who as a punishment would employ a cat of nine tails flogging device and beat the wrongdoers into submission or even silence.
Right.
So, yeah.
So it's not the cat as in your pets, but the cat of nine tails that they beat you to death with.
Right. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that thing's horrible.
It's awful.
I thought it was about cute little cats grabbing your tongue.
With their window paws.
Yeah, purr.
You can't talk now. I have your hand. I have your tongue. Riding or calling shotgun.
Oh, yes. Because in the Old West, on wagon trails, the dude in the seat next to you had the shotgun.
Correct. He was literally protecting the guy driving the carriage.
Yeah.
he was
riding shotgun.
Exactly. But then the number one common phrase with a hidden meaning that you may not know, you guys have all heard it, you're paying through the nose.
That one, correct. I have absolutely no idea.
So, in essence, it just means that you're being charged more than the value of something. Through dictionary and grammarists disagree on its exact origins. They do agree that there was once a practice in which someone would slit people's noses from tip to top if they didn't pay their taxes.
Hmm. Okay, pay your taxes.
So you're paying through the nose.
See, a lien doesn't sound so bad now, does it?
Police in California stopped a truck that had been stolen from right here in Seattle, and you won't believe what else they found inside, Miles.
What did they find in there?
Tell you all about it at 5:50.
Thank you, sir. Headlines are coming up at 5:50. In the meantime, it's going to contest on the line for Profile This at 206-803-ROCK. All right, have we made it to drinking time?
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance, too, with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance, and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at Progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
Without the ones like you, who work tirelessly to keep things running, everything would suddenly stop. Hospitals, factories, schools, and power plants, they all depend on you. No matter the weather, emergency, or time of day, you're the ones who get it done. At Grainger, we're here for you with professional-grade industrial supplies. Count on real-time product availability and fast delivery. Call, clickgrainger.com or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
At Metro, get an iPhone 12 with 5G and a dual camera system for $99.99. Take amazing pictures and share them instantly. And don't put up with life's yada yada.
Yada yada.
Like photo bombers. Zoom, crop out,
yada yada,
and bye.
You don't take yada yada in life, don't take yada yada from your wireless provider. Get iPhone 12 with 5G with no activation fees and nada yada yada. Only at Metro by T-Mobile. Switch to Metro, bring your ID. This offer isn't available for customers currently at T-Mobile or that have been with Metro in the past 180 days.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance too with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance, and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at Progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
Without the ones like you who work tirelessly to keep things running, everything would suddenly stop. Hospitals, factories, schools, and power plants, they all depend on you. No matter the weather, emergency, or time of day, you're the ones who get it done. At Grainger, we're here for you with professional-grade industrial supplies. Count on real-time product availability and fast delivery. Call, clickgrainger.com or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
For those in the market for flavor, there's Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, a flavorful drink that's a modern twist on a Mexican street classic with four vibrant and refreshing flavors. Pineapple, watermelon, hibiscus, and cucumber lime, made with a splash of real fruit juice. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas are perfect for any fiesta, small or big. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, boldly authentic, vibrantly flavorful. Drink responsibly. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas flavored beers imported by Crown Imports, Chicago, Illinois. Hibiscus contains juice only for color.
Hey, Whatcom County. The holidays are over and lots of Americans are financially drained. Luckily, Bayside Coin and Jewelry pays top dollar for scrap gold, jewelry, and gold, silver, or platinum coins. If you have a pile of old jewelry or a stash of silver dollars, bring them into the store and see what they're worth. Or visit PacificRimCoins.com/calculator to get an instant quote using our free scrap calculator. That's PacificRimCoins.com/calculator for an instant quote.
What's up? It's your boy, The Ted Smith from The Men's Room. And did you know I have a podcast? Well, I do. The Podcast. New episodes uploaded every Wednesday on the Odyssey app.
Somebody out there deserves to be recognized. And The Men's Room knows just who it is. So to you, we say, bottoms up, sailor. You're the toast of our shot of the day.
Good time it is, and as usual, we head to the drink desk and Steve at Thrill Hill to find out who we're toasting.
Yes, indeed. And today, we toast a group of tourists on safari in Africa. Man, we've talked about safaris a billion times on this show. And look, we recognize the inherent danger, but just, you know, human curiosity gets the better of you. We live in the States. How cool would it be to see exotic animals?
Cat got your tongue?
Cat's got my, well, maybe. Now, like anyone on safari, the hope was to witness exotic animals doing what they do. And these people, they actually lucked out. Now, from the safety of their covered Jeep, they got to witness two lions, a male and a female, on the prowl. Then the lions approached the Jeep. People get a little bit nervous. But that's when the female climbed on top of their vehicle, followed by the male. But the lions were not stalking the passengers, oh no. Instead, the lions, much like old people in Florida, they used the roof of the Jeep to have sex. For about 2 minutes, the Jeep rocked from side to side while the lions made their sweet, sweet loving. When it was all over, the male rolled out, as men are prone to do, and then the female took a quick nap, as men generally are prone to do, still on top of the Jeep. Now, it should be noted that the roof of the Jeep, it's a metal grate, so the people that were sitting in there got up close and personal with all the lion genitalia that they could handle. And they had to endure any lion juice that may have dripped through.
That was the first thing I thought when I saw that picture.
No one is going to do anything to get them to stop. And keep in mind, when lions mate, like, you might be screaming, oh, God, oh, Lord Jesus. They are growling, they're snarling, they're doing their thing. And these people are sitting maybe 9 inches below them in a grate. And so whatever happens, happens, and they get the full experience. My only question is, what do you think that smelled like?
It smelled bad before they even started their activities.
I'm sure it did. I'm sure they were like, these lions are horny. I can tell by the smell.
Smell good, mama.
Oh, you know what they're about to do. So anyway, we pour this booze and we drink this booze because we think it's yummy.
Yummy!
So over the tongue and down the throat to party in our tummies.
Down the hola, bitola!
The Men's Room presents Profile This.
Hey, Steve, throw hell. Could you please tell everyone how Profile This is played?
I sure can, Miles. It's a simple game where we share with you a real-life news story. Something that happened right here on planet Earth. Earth. And as you listen to the story, based on the stereotypes you believe to be true of people and the decisions that people make, we'll ask you what it is you think makes a story a story. Hello, Jacob. Welcome to the Men's Room.
Hola.
Hola.
Hola. All right, Jacob, you understand how this here game is played?
Yes, sir.
Fantastic. You have your choice of one of three stories. We have the wonderful world of drugs. We have Bite Me, in other words, what did someone find in their food? And finally, hit me with your best shot, where you guess the unconventional weapon that someone chose to use as a weapon.
Oh, I have to go with hit me with your best shot.
Very popular category. I like that our listeners enjoy the violence, as long as it's stupid. All right. We go to, believe it or not, Florida, where a 20-year-old man is behind bars. He's charged with assaulting his sister during a domestic clash in the residence that they share. According to investigators, the assault occurred on Sunday afternoon in the Clearwater home of Kanye Medley and his sibling. Yes, his name is Kanye, and as best we can tell, he's equally as stupid but considerably less talented than his more famous namesake. Now, during a verbal altercation, Kanye grabbed something from his sister and began throwing part of it at her. After being read his rights, Kanye admitted to throwing several objects, one of which hit her. The motive for the assault, Kanye stated, he did this because he had not eaten, but he did not want the food that his sister offered him. So he became upset, which of course begs the question, entitled much? Now, despite the hangry defense, Kanye was arrested for domestic battery, which is a misdemeanor, and booked into the county jail. Now, here's the thing. This is not his first assault my sister rodeo. The 230-pound Kanye, he was arrested earlier this year. Keep in mind, it's May 1st. He was arrested earlier this year for biting and strangling the same sister and slamming a door in her arm and striking her with a piece of what they call wooden decor. Now, the state attorney subsequently declined to pursue a felony or misdemeanor counts because his sister stated she didn't wish to see her brother prosecuted. I am not sure where she stands on this particular case. Anyway, what did this fool assault his sister with? Almost identical to yesterday, was it? Fried chicken, spaghetti, a burrito, or egg rolls. So fried chicken, spaghetti, a burrito, or egg rolls. She came home with one of these four things, offered it to him. He was hungry. That's not what he wanted. So he took it from her and threw it at her.
All four of those make me mad.
I know. I would not waste any food. Of those.
Not what? Threw a piece of it. I feel like that's a clue right there. Let's see. I'm going to have to go with spaghetti.
Spaghetti. That's what it was yesterday.
It was.
Was that movie with Nicolas Cage, The Weatherman?
Yeah, when they kept throwing burritos.
Burrito. Yeah, I'm going to go burrito.
Because that's a good thing to hit someone with, man. I mean, it's not, but I'm saying if you're going to throw food.
Yeah, man, it's like a brick. Even if it's wrapped in aluminum
foil. But it's a malleable brick, you know? It hits them and wraps a little.
You're either in a mood for a burrito or not, I feel like.
He was not in a mood for whatever she brought home, man.
So delicious, but so filling. I mean, I can.
I can't decide fried chicken or egg rolls. I'm going to go egg rolls.
I feel like I'd be in the mood for an egg roll.
All right.
Who's never in the mood? I'm in the mood for all of those things,
all these things sound pretty good.
Good Lord.
So what did he tag his sister with? Fried chicken, spaghetti, burrito, or egg rolls? We'll find out next.
That was a tease.
For those in the market for flavor, there's Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, a flavorful drink that's a modern twist on a Mexican street classic with four vibrant and refreshing flavors. Pineapple, watermelon, hibiscus, and cucumber lime. Made with a splash of real fruit juice. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas are perfect for any fiesta, small or big. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, boldly authentic, vibrantly flavorful. Drink responsibly. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas flavored beers imported by Crown Imports, Chicago, Illinois. Hibiscus contains juice only for color.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance, too, with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance, and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at Progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
Without the ones like you, who work tirelessly to keep things running, everything would suddenly stop. Hospitals, factories, schools, and power plants, they all depend on you. No matter the weather, emergency, or time of day, you're the ones who get it done. At Grainger, we're here for you with professional-grade industrial supplies. Count on real-time product availability and fast delivery. Call, clickgrainger.com or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
99.9 KISW. We return to the men's room with Miles and Thrill.
Categories, hit me with your best shot on profilers. We got a Florida man arrested after assaulting his sister again in their residence. He'd done it earlier this year. This time, he threw something at her because he did not want the food that his sister offered him.
Yeah, he was hungry. She had food, offered it to him, and his response was, let me grab this from you and then hit you with it.
I'm not sure if she made the food, if she picked the food up, whatever the deal is, but the question is, what did he attack his sister with? Was it fried chicken, spaghetti, burritos, or an egg roll?
And Jacob, that is the very question we posed to you. Let us start with our very own Miles Montgomery.
Boo.
Yep. He went the way of Nicolas Cage. Thought it was a burrito. It was not a burrito. Vita Smith, you went with delicious East Coast style, big fat, very unnatural, saturated egg rolls. Which, if you've never eaten one from there, it would do damage. But it was not an egg roll.
Not an egg roll. So Jacob, maybe she got multiple egg rolls.
Did you ever just get one?
No, you always get two.
Never.
No, you get
at
two.
At least two. Or you get two orders and get four.
It's my favorite part of the meal.
God damn, it's so good. I know. And Jacob, you went with spaghetti, which, to be fair, that was the answer yesterday.
It was.
People throw anything, but no, it was not spaghetti. Believe it or not, he threw the fried chicken. More than that, do you know where it was from? She did not make it.
I'll say Popeyes.
Nope. You're tracking. It's Florida, East Coast.
Church's
chicken.
That's pretty good stuff.
I know. That's what pissed me. I'm like, look, man, if she made homemade fried chicken and she sucks at it, I get it. But like, dude, Church, if you like fried chicken, Church's fried chicken is good-ass chicken.
You ever fried chicken just in a pan?
I have, man. It's not that it's bad. It's just one of those foods that no matter what I do, anyway, personally, I can never remotely replicate the 40 places I like to do it.
Yeah, my mom used to do it like once, twice a year, but it was always awesome.
Really?
Yeah.
Damn.
Now for all TV news all the time, time for TV Time with Tan.
And now, because your pathetic life is confined to countless hours in front of a talking box, the Men's Room presents TV Time with Ted.
Ah! Just threw one in there.
Yep, we're good.
All right. Your choices today. You got the Jimmys.
Kimmel and Fallon.
The Colbert fella.
Stephen Colbert.
Fella, yeah.
Seth Meyers. Sure. The Broad. Now, Tomlinson.
Damn.
Well,
Taylor Tomlinson.
Hey, it's not great. She's the only one in late night.
That hysterical chick.
Yeah. Oh, God. You know why she's so funny? Because she's hysterical. Because she has a vagina.
Or Ted Smith.
Is it Ted or is it late night?
It is right there in the title. These guys have talented teams of writers that help them come up with their monologues each and every night. It is up to you to determine, is this an actual late night joke and from whom? Or could it be a The Ted Smith original?
40-year-old man in Colorado has been found guilty of multiple charges, which all started after he went through a Burger King drive-thru and was rejected when he tried to pay with meth instead of cash, which also begs, why was he hungry?
The Ted Smith.
Yes. Yeah, that's right.
You know the reason I know that? Because late night hosts, even though they probably know what we know, they don't delve too much in
drug stuff.
Not drugs, but what you know drugs do to you.
Yeah. Oh,
so,
yeah.
So, right, you know what I mean? Like, they can make a meth joke, but they wouldn't imply that it doesn't make you hungry.
Like, I've seen Breaking Bad. Jesse never really ate. He would binge, but he wouldn't eat for days.
Just lived off pizza the entire series.
It is funny. Every time he wasn't on meth, they were just smoking a lot of weed and eat pizza.
Yeah.
A cat recently reunited with its family in Utah after it was trapped in a box full of Amazon returns and shipped to California. Said one family member, all right, let's try Etsy.
I think it's Myers.
Fallon.
It's Seth.
A cat was recently reunited with its family in Utah after it was trapped in a box filled with Amazon returns and shipped to California. Said one family member, all right, let's try Etsy.
Taylor Swift is now the first artist in history to occupy all the top 14 spots on the Billboard Hot 100 list. She has 14 songs in the top 14 about how people don't like her.
Fallon.
Yeah, Fallon.
Kimmel.
Taylor Swift is now the first artist in history to occupy all of the top 14 spots on Billboard's Hot 100 list. She has 14 songs in the top 14. About how much people don't like her.
Look, man, I'm not a fan of Taylor Swift. I don't dislike her. I'm remarkably indifferent to her existence entirely. But you have to give her credit. Like, that's ridiculous.
I didn't have a ton of thoughts on her. Once I went to that show and just saw the passion of her fans and just excited, like, how much fun they were having. Even the parents just sitting outside in the north lot. Like, yeah, our kids are in there. We just sit out here. You know, it's awesome.
It's my daughter's first concert, right? And again, I couldn't tell you a song. I've heard the name Shake It Off. I don't know what it sounds like. I don't care, but I'm glad she exists.
Dave and Buster's will allow betting on arcade games now. Until now, the only way to gamble at Dave and Buster's was to eat there.
Seth?
Fallon.
You guys see this? Dave and Buster's is going to start allowing customers to bet on arcade games. Until now, the only way to gamble at Dave and Buster's was to eat there.
They actually have pretty decent food.
Yeah, I mean, look, right, it's bar. I'm with you. It's like standard American fare. Mm. Like, come on, Jimmy. Taking a shot at Dave and Buster's? You're the one looking like a buster.
I wish you were a guest on the show. Just to call him out on
that.
We
need another one of those types of establishments downtown again.
Yeah.
Just games, fun.
Go to GameWorks.
Yeah, GameWorks is still there, right?
Yeah. Also, I think that's a wild idea.
What's that? Oh, like, betting on the video games themselves.
Yeah, like, I don't know. Like, if I get matched up with some kid in air hockey, like, I got $20 on this. He's going down. I'm good at air hockey.
Sorry, kids.
Yeah.
We just got dead hustling kids at air hockey.
Yeah, for real.
Yeah, pay it out. Give me that lawnmower money.
Yeah. If I'm down at GameWorks, I'm getting that giant pretzel with the money I won off his.
I mean, look, man, seriously. Once you put money on something, it gets serious.
Yeah,
I know you're a child. I got money on this. Do you have a job? No? Okay.
Is it money or are they betting like points or tickets or whatever?
I should look that up.
Either one. You're still gambling for something.
Right.
Which makes anything more interesting.
God.
I don't know, kid. I'm just not good at this air hockey game. You want to bet?
It does.
Are you an air hockey shark? Ted shows up with his own, what do they call it? What is that? Is it a mallet, a handle?
Oh, we call it a paddle in the biz.
The paddle, yeah. He's got his own paddle, bro. He's got three of them.
I'm dead serious. If you want to play some air hockey, I'll take you on tomorrow. people are like, oh, no, man, I'm pretty good. All right, whatever. While it's a little light, could use another 20.
The last loser said that, too.
Yeah.
It's always good to find a good table, too, that really shoots the air out and keeps the puck up.
Correct.
To make it faster.
Yeah. Sometimes you go to somebody's house or one of those random saloons that still has an air hockey table. It's like, just get it out of here.
There's one in my neighborhood. It sucks.
Right. It doesn't have any air.
It doesn't have enough pressure.
Yeah.
It's like a bad vacuum. It's like, why do I have this?
Right. Yeah. Air hockey needs air. It's almost as bad as some things you need moisture.
Oh, damn. Yeah. They have something for that.
You talking about a sauna?
Still thinking about that chick?
That's why they invented KY.
All right.
If you can't do the job, we'll do it for you.
Let your tongue do the walking.
I got to get to work. I don't have time. All right. You know, baseball games probably just because it's a big grass field, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, sometimes turf. And there's, like, baseball. I like baseball, but there's a lot of lulls in the action.
Sure.
So I feel like when animals get involved, it's most often on a baseball field or a baseball stadium.
It's like a squirrel, dog getting loose, same as like a pitch.
So it's something like that. Like football fields, you don't generally see like birds landing in there because there's a bunch of giant dudes running around on it. So last night we kind of had the same thing with bees. Actually, you know, the Diamondbacks had a little issue with the bees, and here's the commentators talking about it.
Yes, we are in a bee delay, a bee colony that has established a foothold high atop the backstop behind home plate, and thus we remain in a bee delay. Prior to game two of the series here between the Arizona Diamondbacks and the Los Angeles Dodgers, and the bees began swarming, and obviously that's an issue. Blue Sky Pest Control is on their way. The beekeeper made his way, a grand entrance onto the field here at Shea's Field. He was greeted by a standing ovation by the fans here.
I thought I was here to just take care of a bee problem. And we're pretty hyped up. It's pretty cool.
Right. So they put him up on a scissor lift. He gets rid of the bees. People are going crazy. And then the game hasn't started. So then they bring him out to throw out the first pitch.
Awesome.
And he's like trotting out there and just throws back the helmet or the mask or whatever you call it.
Yeah.
And people go nuts.
Hey, man, you made our game happen.
Yeah.
Have you seen...
Also the stall job from the TV crew and the radio crew. Like, you have rain delays. You have all these things you're prepared for. As far as, what do we fill this content with?
Sure.
How do we get through this two-hour delay? Whatever. Because typically, you're broadcasting, you have a formula. But to just sit there and go like, well, this is crazy, for 2 hours.
I mean, honestly, I think it's tougher for the radio guys, because the TV people often...
have visuals.
They have visuals. And
take
like,
a look at him on the field.
And, like, look, if you watch Mariners games on Root, right, there's always Root, like, Mariners all access, this and that.
Sure.
So, you know what I mean? You could yell at the dude in the truck. Don't yell at him. But you could say, hey, man, pull up some of that video. We need to eat up a few.
that's
now I'm that guy.
That's the beauty of the old school guys, man. Like, you know, Vin Scully. They have a relatable because they've been doing that for 40 years.
But also, those guys called the game.
Back in 1973.
But those guys, basically, they were interrupted by the game. Right, I mean, you would listen to them talk and know, like, oh, damn it, man, somebody got a base hit. Because they had to stop telling the story.
So I'm in a hotel room in Sonoma.
That happened to me, or that last night, I watched that, I see the bee stuff.
Yeah.
Then I kind of found myself watching other videos of animals in stadiums.
All right.
So there's a famous one with the eagle down in Auburn. He's soaring around. They're like war eagle. And he runs into a luxury suite. And just, just falls down.
Oh, yeah, the glass.
I'll assume all these birds are fine.
Of course.
But I saw another one where a goose is on the field, and it's like he can't really get a full takeoff. And he's, like, running, then he's getting away. Security's chasing him. And they're like, oh, there he goes. He's in flight. He should be good. Oh.
Didn't the Seahawk do that?
And he runs into something and just flops down. But there's just a couple sitting there. Can you imagine you're at a baseball game and a goose knocks himself out and flops?
Did the Seahawk decide to take a couple extra laps or something like that?
I don't think he ran in anything, but I think he took a couple
extra laps. He was not coming back to his handler.
Do you remember the animal they featured in the movie Naked Gun? So they're showing the baseball game and then they show the baseball bloopers, right?
Oh, you talking about the second baseman get eaten by a lion?
It was a tiger.
A tiger.
But they show like, you know, this guy, oh, he missed this, or this guy hit a home run, and then random tiger comes out and mauls a player.
I also watched, I did finish The Gentleman. As I told Mike earlier today, I think The Gentleman on Netflix, very good series. With the preface of, if you like Guy Ritchie, watch it. It's obviously a Guy Ritchie thing.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't like his movies, I wouldn't bother. If you don't know who Guy Ritchie is and you like gangster stuff, and like I would watch it.
Okay, that's fair. That's fair.
Yeah, and it's pretty good. A lot of twists and turns. I also started a new show called, I think it's Mud Madness.
Mud Madness.
Or Mud Mayhem. It's basically following along people that race, that go mudding. Giant tires and everything.
Sure.
But it's like a competition, and like you can win some money off it, this and that. Like, I was expecting more of the party angle. This is just a lot of people that have a lot of crazy mud toys that
I think seem that's to, generally, yeah, the thing.
Seem to really be barking at each other. I also, to their credit, I have no idea what they're doing. The tires are massive. Some of the chicks are kind of hot. But yeah, it's just like, I know. I thought about that. Last night as I'm watching it, I'm like, don't mention that. but like, they're so serious about it. And I just like the smack talk back and forth. Like most of them, like if I was driving a mud vehicle, I don't know what you call them. They're not all Jeeps. Some of them are like four wheelers. They're not even covered up. Some of them are just these little buggies. But I mean, the tires are massive.
Yeah.
But like traditionally, people go in there with just like a t-shirt on and like a helmet. And then like one guy had on like a whole suit so he wouldn't get all wet. And they weren't having that.
Yeah.
They're basically like, look at this pee. Like, what's he got? It's like, you're mudding. You better get a little mud on you.
Yeah, if you're going to go mudding, I think you should be prepared for that, right?
Have you thought about checking out Baby Reindeer yet? I heard it's pretty, pretty hard to watch.
I have not. I saw the preview.
But isn't that like an English kind of comedy?
I don't know,
man. It seems like it's in your wheelhouse, but I don't know. Apparently, it's very dark.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I was all over the place last night. I was taping a brand new set of The Podcast. Watched a little bit of hockey, finished The Gentleman, then I was like, let's get into this goddamn Mud Madness. let's see what these SOBs are actually doing.
You got some more NBA and NHL on tonight. And credit where credit's due. Some of the NBA series, I'm not the, but like they're close. They're getting good.
Yeah.
It's really just a matter of the Knicks and the Sixers because they're I think they're all a-holes. So I don't care who wins. I just like them going back and forth.
Thank you, Ted. We appreciate it. You're listening to Men's Room.
At Metro, get an iPhone 12 with 5G and a dual camera system for $99.99. Take amazing pictures and share them instantly. And don't put up with life's yada yada.
Yada yada.
Like photo bombers. Zoom, crop out,
yada yada,
and bye.
You don't take yada yada in life. Don't take yada yada from your wireless provider. Get iPhone 12 with 5G with no activation fees and nada yada yada. Only at Metro by T-Mobile. Switch to Metro, bring your ID. This offer isn't available for customers currently at T-Mobile or that have been with Metro in the past 180 days.
I'm Sandra, and I'm just the professional your small business was looking for. But you didn't hire me, because you didn't use LinkedIn Jobs. LinkedIn has professionals you can't find anywhere else, including those who aren't actively looking for a new job, but might be open to the perfect role, like me.
In a given month, over 70% of LinkedIn users don't visit other leading job sites. So if you're not looking on LinkedIn, you'll miss out on great candidates, like Sandra. Start hiring professionals like a professional. Post your free job on linkedin.com/recommend today.
Looking for a job is lonely. Endless searching, phone calls that go nowhere, applications that vanish into thin air. What if you could link with dozens of local companies who are hiring right now with just one connection? That's Express Employment Professionals. Find us at expresspros.com. One connection, endless opportunities. And no fees ever for job seekers. Express Employment Professionals. ExpressPros.com.
The Men's Room returns with Miles and Thrill. Now, let's see what's happening in the real world.
All right, here we go. Miami TSA catches a man trying to smuggle a bag of snakes in his pants. Meanwhile, when a first date ends with a woman shooting at you, the relationship does not stand a chance. Cops find a stolen Seattle pickup in Cali with drugs, goats, and chickens inside. Two men busted at Heathrow with a suitcase full of cocaine they were trying to hide. And a 9-year-old hits a home run the day after, saving his parents' life. It's time for your headlines.
Now, it's time to hit the headlines. Here's Mike Hawk.
All right, our top story. We head down to a town just north of Sacramento, California, where officers notice a suspicious truck. They stopped the vehicle suspecting it of being stolen and were able to confirm that it actually had been taken from the Seattle area. While placing the driver under arrest, they conducted a search of the truck where they found over 70 grams of methamphetamine, hundreds of counterfeit pills, and also decided to confiscate the goats and chickens that were riding along in the truck as well.
And why are they there? That's all I want to know.
Right.
I get the drug thing, do your thing, or I'd get it if it's a livestock thing, but like both?
Really? Both, right. And it begs a question, were they there since the Seattle area, or did he actually stop somewhere? Like, hang on, I need these goats and chickens.
I don't know because people are stupid, but
they are.
You would assume they picked them up on the way. Because if I say, Mike, look, man, I know the truck that has drugs we're looking for, we get our cash, blah, blah, blah. But if I also knew that there were chickens and goats in it, like, we're going to get rid of them first and just take our drugs.
Sure.
Right, you know what I mean? I don't want anything to call attention to the fact that I have an illegal vehicle.
Or maybe it was camouflage, man. They're never going to suspect a truck hauling goats and chickens will be doing something illegal.
This is why we cannot be crime partners, because we'd be debating this. Mike, I disagree.
We're just sitting in the truck. Right. Come on, man. The animals were taken to a shelter, and the driver is now facing several charges. In other news, speaking of smuggling, we go to the UK where a trio were stopped by authorities for the contents of their luggage. Three suitcases were flagged coming off of a flight from Jamaica. And the owners were interviewed by national crime agents after they were found to contain 45 kilos of cocaine, about $4.5 million worth.
Damn.
They're now facing a ton of charges.
Mm-hmm.
I bet they are.
Again, it's just the brazen nature of just throwing it in your suitcase and running it through.
Like, what is your plan? Why do you think it'll work?
Right.
Why do you mean? Think they're not going to check these things? If I have $4.5 million of cocaine, and I'm trying to shepherd this stuff to a different country over international border, right, I just feel like I would have given this a lot of thought. Not, you know what, man? Just put it in your suitcase and let's just hope.
Right.
And you got to remember, too, that like a lot of times, like the cartels and stuff, man, people get sucked into it. They don't know how don't realize
they give you the
stuff.
And
then they'll just also be like, no, it'll be totally fine. You'll be fine. Right, like, so let's say somehow Mike gets involved and he does a couple of these deals and it's never been caught.
Yeah,
he's
well,
like,
I have
Ted,
not.
you should come along. When I show up, they might just be like, you're taking this.
Did you see
that? And if you throw in, I mean, that's the other thing, too. It's like volume, right? Like, if you just, their theory is, if we just throw enough at it, enough will get through.
Did you see the ages of the guys?
60-some.
68.
Correct.
17. 72 and 17.
Yeah, you wouldn't suspect them automatically.
Exactly.
You are correct.
Makes a good mule.
Yeah.
Apparently it doesn't.
One more from TSA down in Miami. A man was stopped after it was discovered that he had a stowaway. The man was attempting to transport a small bag of pink snakes through the airport.
Ugh.
And he saw fit to stow them where all snakes go, in his pants. The reptiles were turned over to local Fish and Wildlife Commission. The man's facing charges.
You think when he went through the x-ray thing, they're like, that man has 15 penises.
There are snakes in these pants.
Nah, that's just me, man.
Well, at least I didn't get on the plane.
I'm a Medusa genitalia.
Oh, God, that would be terrible.
Especially if they try to bust you and you're like, literally, I have 15 snake penises. Just, I don't know what to talk
snake
about.
Pubes. Snake pubes. Snake pubes. Don't look at it. You'll turn to stone.
Dang it.
Don't look at my penis.
Sticking with Florida, you have to be on the lookout for the crazies in the dating pool. A man agreed to meet up with a woman that he had connected with online, and the pair made their way to her place. Inside her domicile, the woman attempted to seduce the man, but also demanded money in the process, which is very romantic.
Oh, hey, very romantic.
You wanna get busy and also pay me? What's more is...
Isn't that prostitution?
Yeah.
What's more is that when he attempted to leave, she blocked his exit and pulled a gun on him.
Oh, lovely.
He was eventually able to get out the door, but the woman opened fire on his vehicle as he made his escape. Nobody was injured in the encounter, and the woman is facing several charges.
Good.
How dare you?
Yeah. Wait, oh, well. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know what to say at that point. Like... open and shut. Well done. And just in case the story's up to bad taste in your mouth...
thankfully, there's good news.
To Oklahoma, where heroism knows no age. This is an incredible story. A family had piled into the truck in order to seek shelter from an oncoming tornado that was tearing through the neighborhood one night. But their efforts were in vain as the cyclone lifted the truck into the air and smashed it into a tree. Jeez. The man driving suffered a broken back, neck, sternum, ribs, and arm. He also lost a couple fingers, if I'm not mistaken.
Wow.
While his wife in the passenger seat sustained a broken back, neck, ribs, jaw, and hand, as well as a punctured lung in the crash.
Not her jaw!
Yeah, oh, come on. As they lay there, they heard the voice of their 9-year-old son, who was in the back seat at the time of the terrifying toss, sustaining no significant injuries, telling him that he'd be right back. He was literally like, Mom, Dad, please don't die. I will be right back. He then proceeded to run a full mile in just 10 minutes, navigating his way amongst downed power lines and debris with only lightning strikes illuminating the terrain to help him, to get help from a neighbor and friend. His parents are now in the ICU recovering from their injuries, and the kid's baseball team started a fundraiser to give his family some financial aid as they heal. And Miles said it during the setup there. I believe his first game back, he cracked a home run while his parents were
And he has a mullet.
Oh, yeah.
Did you see the kid? Yeah.
Oklahoma. Of course he does.
He looks like the one kid that I'd be like,
what are their haircuts available?
Like, I guarantee you this kid's going to figure it out.
Says it on the board. Mullets, $10.
Dude, watch little kids play Little League now. It's mullets, and they all have eye black, like, just down the face.
All right.
Oh, it's a whole scene. Well, you know what? While we're talking about sports, let's get into men's room sports. Your Seattle Mariners came through big last night, beating the Atlanta Braves 3-2 to take the series. They concluded that series this afternoon with Emerson Hancock getting the start, and unfortunately they did fall short in that one, losing 5-2. But hey, they still took the series against the best team in baseball. Suck it, Atlanta. They're off tomorrow before they go into a 3-game series in Houston against the Astros, with George Kirby getting the nod in Game 1. The NBA playoffs continue over on TNT tonight with Game 5 between the Heat and the Celtics on right now, with Boston leading that series 3-1, and that'll move over into Game 5 in the tied series between the Mavericks and the Clippers. Meanwhile, in the NHL playoffs, the Hurricanes took the series to move on into Round 2, as did the Avalanche. Meanwhile, tonight, we've got a couple Game 5s on ESPN. Currently, we're in the thick of the tied series between the Golden Knights and the Stars, and that'll move into game between the Kings and the Oilers, with Edmonton currently leading the series 3-1, looking to punch their ticket to the next round. As far as your weather, clear skies continue tonight and into tomorrow, with temperatures hitting the mid-60s around 5 in the afternoon. Yeah. It's going to be nice out there, gang. Hooray. And that is it for your headlines. With that, Mike Hawk is out.
Kevin Deere's up next with more Metallica tickets every day in May.
That's right, but don't call it Metallica. No. Don't do that. We've been told not to, so we're not going to call it Metallica. In the meantime, we be all about this bitch. So until next time, please do what you do best. And for Aletha's sake, stay beautiful.
The Men's Room has been taped before a live studio audience. Wardrobe and makeup provided by Mantastic Limited. This has been a presentation of the Men's Room Radio Network.
Oh, man.
A Double Flush production.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance too with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance, and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at Progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
Without the ones like you who work tirelessly to keep things running, everything would suddenly stop. Hospitals, factories, schools, and power plants, they all depend on you. No matter the weather, emergency, or time of day, you're the ones who get it done. At Grainger, we're here for you with professional-grade industrial supplies. Count on real-time product availability and fast delivery. Call, clickgrainger.com or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
For those in the market for flavor, there's Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, a flavorful drink that's a modern twist on a Mexican street classic with four vibrant and refreshing flavors. Pineapple, watermelon, hibiscus, and cucumber lime. Made with a splash of real fruit juice. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas are perfect for any fiesta, small or big. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas. Boldly authentic, vibrantly flavorful. Drink responsibly. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas flavored beers imported by Crown Imports, Chicago, Illinois. Hibiscus contains juice only for color.